see the link and that you're spreading it like wildfire, right? And the technical streaming team, exhibitors all, ladies and gentlemen, a pleasant, pleasant morning to you. All right, just an announcement. Motor vehicle 5401GR. I see Mobay School. It needs to move. And then 5593JC. The window is down. So 5401GR, Mobay School, needs to move. And 5593JC, if you have no valuables in your car, you don't need to go, but if you have, you should probably go by. By way of greetings this morning, I want to start off by saying that we live in a time and an era when bad news seem to be the norm, and sharing bad news seem to be an exciting hobby of most persons. We live in an era where gloom and doom seems to also be the order of the day. And if that is not enough, we live in an era where it's difficult to focus on any one thing, so that even you here in this room now, you're probably finding it difficult to focus, especially if you have a smartphone in your hand, because the distractions are so many. If we are not careful, we would fall into the trap of believing that nothing is going well. And it is amazing that for many of us, we accept the notion that everything is hopeless and that our God, our Almighty God, is not still on the throne. I mean, only recently in December, we celebrated his death, and then by Easter, and I say celebrate because we know what comes after, that the death was necessary in order to facilitate the resurrection. By Easter, we celebrated resurrection, and yet it appears that we have no hope. You know, I find it amazing that the Bible says to us, be anxious for nothing. And what is true is that many persons are anxious for just about everything. And many of these persons, numbered among them, are Christian people. I think that's something for us to consider. We live in an era when education is not valued. And I think we see that by virtue of the remuneration, the treatment, the facility that are made available to educators. So is the education system and educators at large. But then this morning, I want to suggest to us that there is a beacon of light in terms of the theme this morning. It says, advancing education, igniting your passion. I'm hoping that today we're going to take time out to put aside the negative and to embrace the positive. To say to ourselves that there is still hope, because there is still hope. May I encourage all of us to exhale the negative, even now, symbolically, exhale the negative and inhale the positive, only to exhale positive going forward. I say to us all, God is still on the throne, there is still hope. Education is still relevant. Let us continue to unite and serve.
Thank you kindly, Dr. Mark Nicely. Colleagues all, we are in fact in interesting times. We are at an age or a cusp in our evolution where we have now moved headfirst towards artificial intelligence. Many of us may have trepidations or anxieties about artificial intelligence, but as a teacher of history, I will tell you that technological advancements do not take away your jobs. People using technological advancements will take your jobs away. You can therefore secure your jobs by ensuring that you are on the cutting edge of said technological advancement. Someone who is on the cutting edge of whatever happens in the daily news is now going to come to us. Help me welcome your president, Mrs. Lasagna Harrison.
Chairman of today's proceedings, Deputy Secretary General, past President, Mr. Clayton Hall, President-elect, Mr. Layton Johnson, immediate past President, JP, Mr. Winston Smith, or Secretary General, Justice of the Peace as well, Dr. Mark Nicely, or keynote speaker, Dr. Jawala. I pray I did not do an injustice to your name, sir. Or Assistant Secretary General, Dr. Margaret Chin, officers and other members of staff of the JTA, presenters and specially invited guests, members and friends of the Jamaica Teachers Association on our virtual platforms, our technical team streaming from this conference, exhibitors, ladies and gentlemen, nurses, lawyers, mediators, investigators, counselors, motivational speakers, development coach, practitioners, financiers, those who help to subsidize educational offering by providing lunch money, textbooks, uniform, intercessors, all that we are to the children and more. Colleagues, all, good morning. You just sound like you didn't identify yourself in all the roles that you play, all under the one umbrella called teacher. Oh Lord. Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay, great. I am happy that you are happy. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Belated Teachers' Day to you. We continue to celebrate ourselves. Amen. And what it is that we do. So teaching remains the engine through which nations nurture its greatest resource, its human capital. The gatekeepers, midwives, facilitators of this process are our ever-sacrificing practitioners, you, whose professional development remains central to the process in providing this social good called education to our children. The theme, Advancing Education, Igniting Your Passion, speaks to what we do daily. As practitioners, we remain intrinsically motivated for the most part, remembering primarily the call on our lives to serve in this noble profession and equally critical pillar for national development. Commendations to you, my colleagues. Come, clap yourselves. High five your neighbor and say, girl, boy, it's good that you're here.
I'm not sure which pronoun.
I am sure, girl or boy. High five your neighbor and say, it's good to see you here. So commendations to you, as once again you demonstrate your commitment to personal and professional development. The nation's children and the education system in general will undoubtedly reap dividends from our improved skills and competencies. This testifies of our love for this island home, Jamaica, and our awesome profession. Thank you, my colleagues, for choosing to remain in Jamaican classrooms despite the ongoing challenges. We commit to continue lobbying on your behalf. And I just want to insert here, I don't have it, but I must say that the calls are not going in vain. We have a meeting coming up to discuss some of those outstanding matters that we have been pressing in for. You are critical, my colleagues, to our nation, continued achievement of its mandate. A mandate embedded in Judeo-Christian principles, one that says that Jamaica may, under God, increase in beauty, fellowship, and prosperity, and play her part in advancing the welfare of the whole human race. You, my colleagues, are vanguards of this mandate. You are a brand. Say, I'm a brand. Indeed, you are a brand and you need to believe it. You need to walk it, talk it, sleep it, wear it. Yes, and you need to ensure that you promote that brand. Find creative ways of your investment, of using your investment here today for reaping dividends as you build your professional capital. What will be on offer today, I am sure you will appreciate, appraise, and apply. It would be remiss of me not to thank Dr. Chin, who single-handedly planned this event. Today's events, they are indeed her brainchild. Let me extend additional thanks to the members of the Professional Advancement and Teacher Welfare Committee who are here assisting in executing the day's activities. Colleagues, be encouraged. Colleagues, be encouraged. And you know that song that says sometimes you have to speak a word to yourself? Yes, you have to encourage yourself. And sometimes you have to speak a word over your situation to encourage yourself. The journey, as our devotion team this morning is said, is indeed long, but your work is not in vain. We must press in and press on. Our children depend on it. We are the beacons of hope for many of those children. AI technology, sir, cannot replace the humanity that you and I bring to the teaching and learning space that must remain in the Jamaican classroom. So I want to say to you, if by now you have not yet shared your pay slips, if there are challenges, please to do so to that jtasalary@gmail.com, because we need that documentation to take us to that meeting that we're going to tomorrow. Every blessing to you, my colleague, as you enjoy today's offering and pamper yourselves. Blessings to you.
Thank you kindly, Madam President, for those wise words. And speaking of umbrella, if you are happy with the Teachers' Day gift, you have to hear the question first. If you are happy with the Teachers' Day gift, the President and I were integral in the procurement. If you are not, we had no knowledge of it until it was delivered. But to provide an umbrella coverage for today's activities, we invite Dr. Margaret Chin to give an overview. Dr. Chin.
Our chairman, Mr. Clayton Hall, Deputy Secretary General, Member Services and Industrial Relations, our President, Mrs. LaSonia Harrison, our President-elect, Mr. Layton Johnson, our immediate past President, Mr. Winston Smith, Secretary General, Dr. Mark Nicely, I am not seeing Dr. Pinnock as yet, our keynote speaker, the noted Dr. Rohan Jawala, officers and other members of staff of the JTA, our presenters who are here, I know Dr. Carly Dunbar is here, Mrs. Anyona Jones is here, members and friends of the Jamaica Teachers Association on our virtual platform, our technical team who is doing the streaming as we speak, our exhibitors, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. You just got some coffee break. Good morning. That sounds a little bit better. Today is a day that we will not experience again. Today is a day that we create memories. And today is a day when we exhale. And I got goosebumps when Sekjen was speaking, because those were the things that were in my thoughts that he mentioned about exhaling the positive. And it is so important for us to stop some time and exhale. And so today was planned carefully for you to exhale. From the minute you got your token and you open it and look and you exhale, to when you leave here this afternoon. So today we're going to be pampering you. Today was created for you. The program was designed to look at you in a holistic fashion. So we're going to start with the classroom, talking about how we can ignite and reignite our passion. And that will be our first plenary. Our second will deal with your mental health and wellness. And we close off by talking about the all-important relationships that we have in our lives. So our keynote speaker, Dr. Jawala, will lay the foundation for us, a very noted gentleman, well sought after, and we are so privileged, Dr. Jawala, to have you here. He flew from overseas to be here with us. He is a Jamaican and he loves us very dearly. So just some information for you. We have established a help desk for persons who are still having issues with your salary. So we have a team in our secretariat right across the hallway through the glass door. And if you have your pay slips with you, February, March, April, they'll be able to assist you with any issues you have with your salaries. We also will be having our self-care services being offered. We have massage being done. We have manicure, makeup. Unfortunately, the barber called this morning to say he's done with the flu. So unfortunately, we won't be able to have those eyebrows being shaped. And yeah, he's done with the flu. I hear Mr. Hall saying that he can deputize. Dr. Nice is also a good barber. Wonderful. So we have two barbers in the house who can sit in for us. Oh, I understand Dr. Nicely has a hair to prove it, that he's a good barber, okay? So if you want to make note, Hart College of Beauty Services, they'll be providing massage, makeup, manicure, and so on, and they will be in the Seville room right across from the exhibitors. G.C. Foster College will be offering massages, and they're in the Belfield room. The signs are on the door, so you can't miss it. So remember now, so we have the help desk, we have the self-care services, and we have our exhibitors all outside to serve you. So after lunch, and that's the beauty with how things were set up, we thought about you. You don't have to go anywhere for lunch. You'll be served your lunch right here and you come back into the room. At 1:30, we'll be having a karaoke show. And I can take this time out. We need 10 persons to volunteer to be a part of our show. If you look in the back of the room, you'll see prizes and surprises that will be given to all 10 people who will participate. We have our PAC people on hand. They're in the back. Just give them your name. So we'll have a karaoke show. We have prizes. We have giveaways. And just as I said, exhale. Enjoy today. It's a spillover from yesterday when you had your teachers there, and I'm sure you all had a wonderful day. So that's basically what our program will look like today. You all should have a program in your possession. If you don't, please let us know. We'll get one to you. So enjoy your day. Sit back, relax, enjoy, and I wish you all God's richest blessing. Thank you.
Of course, we thank Dr. Chin. She's the main organizer. So if you have any questions, queries, recommendations, you'd want to go to Dr. Chin. I am here again because I don't want to leave the umbrella story just yet. I don't want to leave it just yet. Because the fact that Mr. Hall has declared that neither himself or the president had nothing to do with it, then it would suggest that I have a lot to do with it. So I don't know how many of you saw the video. You saw the video. And I look at things a little differently. So let me tell you about a video before that video. So there's a video with the police and who was beating the gentleman because he boxed her. You saw that one? And I looked at that video and many persons were saying different things, you know. Look at how the lady beat the man. Look at how the man boxed the lady. But you know, the real problem with that video is that there is a disregard for women in our country and a disregard for women in authority. So there are a lot of men in particular that have a challenge handling when a woman is in charge. So when they are stopped on the road and is a man police, they react a certain way. But when it's a female police, they react another way. So let me fast track now to the umbrella and the video I saw. Colleagues, I think that we have outdone ourselves this time around with the token. We gave you a token, and our intention, the theme for Teachers Day was we have you covered. We have you covered. And so the token served the purpose of covering you. But then, as the Secretary General, I have to look beyond, and I have to see the horizon. And I know that the President has a particular Labor Day emphasis about school gardening and so forth and so on. And when I watched the video, I realized that the umbrella also served the purpose of water harvesting. And it just goes to show how flexible the Jamaica Teachers Association is. And I want for you to give us a hand for the sterling work that we do in this organization. Thank you.
That is why he is the Secretary General. He understands that the umbrella identified as an umbrella in one instance, and then identified as a water catchment facility in another. Be not perturbed. Colleagues all, we are at the time for entertainment. And I just want to indicate that unlike the Secretary General, my disposition towards police officers, whether they are male or female, has nothing to do with their gender. I just know that if I am pulled over by a female police and she says you will get a ticket, I wait patiently for it. If I'm pulled over by a male officer, then I may ask for a blight. I may indicate some other extenuating circumstances why I may need to get home quickly, and males are more likely to assist. Because our entertainers are not here, I am going to do a poem. So So this is a dub, and you will have to assist me by snapping your fingers. Ready? You have to catch the beat. Ready? That sounds good. And it says, me can't believe what a gwine in a me nation. Can't believe what a gwine in education. Modern society a turn me in a madman. Girl, them turn hot. Boy, them turn done. Can't believe. Spanish now? No queer cola pasa con la educación. No. At this time. Money pull up. Yes. So I am looking forward to seeing myself on TikTok in a bit. But that's at this time we're going to invite Mr. German Williams to introduce our keynote speaker. Mr. Williams.
Thank you, sir. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, good morning. It is my distinct pleasure to introduce to you our keynote speaker. Our keynote speaker is Dr. Rowan Joala. Stands out as a prominent expert with over 30 years of experience in education. Drawing from his extensive knowledge and personal experiences, Dr. Joala offers insightful lectures and presentations. His exceptional public speaking abilities and engaging conversations on crucial topics impacting daily life make him a sought-after speaker. Having taught in the Caribbean, England, and the United States, Dr. Joala has experience across various educational levels, such as elementary, middle, and high schools and universities. His diverse background in education allows him to present course material through multiple formats like online, in-person, and blended learning. As a prolific writer and researcher, Dr. Joala has numerous publications, including a book and several book chapters. He continually pursues new writing and research opportunities and has acted as a reviewer for multiple international journals, and has acted, all right, his research interests cover critical education issues, emerging technologies like AI and XR, learning spaces and inclusion. In 2022, he received the Research Incentive Award at UCF, which acknowledges faculty scholarly work and its impact. Dr. Johala's impressive academic qualifications include a doctorate in language and literacy in education from the University of Sheffield, an MED in special needs and inclusion studies from the Open University, a bachelor's of science in psychology from the Open University, a graduate certificate in teaching and learning in higher education from the University of Wolverhampton, a diploma in secondary education from Bethlehem Moravian College, and a certificate in social work from the University of the West Indies School of Continuing Studies. Dr. Joala is a senior instructional designer at the University of Central Florida and holds adjunct faculty positions at two universities. He also maintains an active YouTube vlogging channel, sharing his research interests and educational insights with over 2,500 subscribers through more than 205 videos, uploading new content weekly. Dr. Joala has given over 60 presentations throughout his career, including 26 invited talks and over 5 keynote speeches. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you our keynote speaker, Dr. Rowan Joala.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. I move the table to be closer to you. All right? Thank you. All right, observing all protocols, I want to say thanks for the introduction.
Colleagues all, are you seeing the properly?
Thank you again, observing all protocols. I want to say thanks, everyone, for this invite. JTA, thanks for the invitation. I want to say, as I walk the crowd this morning, I realize that we have so many things to be, we are connected to. I saw my past colleagues. I saw individuals who were working in areas that I've worked before. And I must say that I'm moved. I'm moved because what you are doing and continue to do is going to have its impact on the world, on society. So as I started off by saying, we are on a journey together. The journey is not going to be easy. But as we go, we must be passionate about what we do. As stated in the introduction, I have taught in several areas. I taught at the Montego Bay Secondary School, now St. James High. I taught at the All-Aid School up by Mount Zion. I taught at the Montego Bay Infant School, where I was the only male teacher there. And boy, in Jamaican terms, them walked me out. If there was a speaker box to move, Mr. Joala, you can't move that box. Sometimes, students did. And the bottom line is, one day I was talking to a boy who had sculled my class. He had missed my class. And I said to him, I'm going to punish you for this. And during that time, it was acceptable to do certain things. Now it's gone. You can't do it. And as I was about to put the first dose of medication on this child, a female teacher said to me, that's not how you do it. Let me show you how. And when she put on the first one, I had to say no more. Because she had given him the medication that he deserved because the younger ones were looking through. So as I go through today, I want to share with you my passion, what has driven me to the point where I am at, and how to maintain and sustain that, because that's important. Because if you don't do that in today's times, you'll find yourself lagging behind. And you can't afford that. So let me start off. Oh, I'm going too fast. If you see this sign, it means that you should write down a critical point. I might have a giveaway that you will have in the end. And I have two things I'm going to give away. So just bear in mind these talks. Now, my starting point. I like to think about the starting point. Where did I start my teaching career? At the time when I was going... Okay, all right, thank you. My starting point was somewhat had no connection to teaching. As a matter of fact, I did not believe I would have become an educator. In high school, I had other visions. And through a crisis of various elements taking place in my life, I happened to have had some individuals who said to me, you have to find a passion. Let me ask, everyone in this space today, did you all started all thinking that you would become teachers? Something changed your mind. Something altered you. But I had an aunt who said to me, you must find a profession. Find a profession and something that will allow you to be able to contribute to society. So I started out. I went to a community college and then I got a job. It's dangerous when you get jobs early in your life. Because you find that money so sweet, you can't bother with going back to school again. So I challenge young men, if you think you're going to work for us, go and get a skill or go to a higher education institution because you have that framework. Money was running and I felt good because I could buy my red shoes, my acid wash jeans, and a few more things. I don't know, you might calculate the year. That was in the 80s when Miami Vice shorts were being worn. So I happened to say, I applied for every teacher's college in Jamaica. I even applied to St. Joseph's. They wrote me back. Dear Rohan Jawala, we are sorry, but we do not accept males in our institution. Because guess what? I was searching. So eventually, I did one interview. One interview. And that was at Bethlehem Teachers College. And by the way, I had no intentions of going there. But I had a supervisor who said to me, Rohan, this is not the place for young people. So when people tell you about your passion and say to you at a certain point, I don't want you to stay here, I see you going further, listen to them. But as life would pause for a moment, Hurricane Gilbert came. Gilbert came, and when I went back to my job, I was standing in water. And they handed me a check for $306. And I called up Bethlehem and said to them, like a prodigal son, I have committed a sin. I did not tell you that I wanted to come to your institution. And that is when my teaching started. So wherever you are starting and your starting point, it's not where you start, but what energy you put in. And the energy you put in should be able to sustain you throughout. Because as I said, I had no starting point. And like many of you, you had no starting point in considering education until that crisis, that moment in time that changed your life. So as I look forward, I'm going to talk about passion. Passion is an energy. Passion is a desire. Passion is something that allows you to continue and sustain that vigor, that energy, that's lasting. Passion is something that you love, something that you embrace. Passion is about caring for others, allowing yourself to leave a legacy. Passion is good. But my question to you, audience, is there a bad side of passion? Is there a bad side of passion? Answer me, say yes or no. Yes, there is a bad side of passion because passion is a complex thing. It is very complex. Passion is so complex that it will create problems. Because as one writer stated, that passion can be something that will create that movement, but that passion also can be destructive. You ever hear the term? Boy, them stab me in my back. You're so passionate about something that you don't even care about others. But we are not here to talk about the negative side of passion. We are talking about the passion that will embrace you as an individual. The passion that will allow you to be committed and to revisit what or where you started from. Because without this reflection, what is going to happen? You stay in that zone and be consistent in that zone of comfort. But I want to tell you, if you're passionate today or revisiting your passion, think out of the box. I think the next slide is not moved. Okay, has moved. So therefore, the first focal point is harmonious passion and the passion that's destructive. Because there's actually passion that can destroy you. And we don't want that passion. So I'm giving you 10 seconds to reflect on that prompt. Write down a response. if necessary. Next slide. Now, I want to talk about passion and money. Who wants to talk about passion and money? I start off by saying that many people who chase money will eventually find that they have something missing in the early of their lives. And the second point is, if you chase your passion, sometimes you will get the money. I want to also remind individuals, and I'm going to take myself out there. I'm going to take myself out of the comfort zone and then put myself back in. You will say to me, and I ask myself, should I say this? And I'm going to say it. I left Jamaica in 2001. And you say, oh, he chased money. If you believe I chased money, you can say yes. Say yes. I didn't. Really? You said yes? Yes, I did chase the money a bit. A bit. Why do I say a bit? Because at that time, I wanted to educate myself. And I'm reflecting on the thought of education, and I've always been about learning. And I saw the opportunity to, yes, get some money, but to also learn. Why do I say this? I say this to say that many teachers who left this country and went away eventually did not chase the passion of educating themselves. So when I became a qualified teacher back in UK, many of them still were not qualified. Thank you. This brings me to the point. If they had chased passion with some element of money, it would have been okay. But when we talk about passion and money, I want to share a story with you. I want to share a story with you because I think it's important for me to highlight the balance. Because money is important, but I think what I've been doing over the period of time is thinking about my passion. In 1998, I had a boss. He's now deceased. And this boss said to me, and the other individuals working for various parishes in Jamaica, he wanted to see us in Kingston, that because we were talking a lot of things regarding what we wanted to change. So he called us up in Kingston. We sat down round a table and he asked us to write what we are passionate about. So some of them wrote. I didn't. I refused. He then asked what motivates us most. And of course, some individuals wrote down, what do you think they wrote down? What motivates them the most? What? Yes. He had asked a question and now he was reviewing the data and he was not happy. You could see the man's countenance change. He said, I thought you were all about working for the betterment of Jamaica and the people of Jamaica, and now you're talking about money. And someone said, but you asked for it, sir, you got it. But what I'm saying, over a period of time, if you balance the passion, I think the money will come. Because I don't know how connected this experience is, but you know some contractors, they are very passionate. And once they collect your money, the passion is gone. Have you ever had a contractor like that? So we have to be very careful about the people we see with passion who cannot sustain that with work. It's gone again. Now, the next slide I want to share is about discovering your passion. I want you to take a moment to consider how you discovered your passion. And in discovering your passion, I want to tell you at this point in time, there are certain points in your life that you really have to consider, where are you going? Have you ever been in a process that you re-examine your passion? You ask yourself, why are you teaching? Why are you engaging? Why did you become an educator? Those are all good critical questions. As a motivator called Tony Gibbons stated, your passion will emerge when you are studying yourself. You're studying what you like the most. You're examining what areas you've given attention to. Your passion can come from what the world also needs. Jamaica needs strong educators, educators willing to put their life into service so other fellow Jamaicans can succeed. At times, you have to take yourself away and you have to say, I am going to put myself out there at risk. So sometimes your passion can be emerging from any aspect. But one story I'd like to talk about is a friend called Christopher Zaidi. Christopher Zaidi had played football for Jamaica. His team had won the Manning Cup. And Chris had started his teaching career roughly, I would say, 15, 20 years ago. And I saw that someone had made a shift from being a sportsman. He had gone to Columbia to study. And Chris eventually became a teacher. And Chris had a passion for teaching. He had a passion that I have never seen before. So when you think about certain things, you have to think about how do you sustain that passion and maintain that passion for a period of time. Next slide, please. It's not working. Growing your passion. Have you put your hands up if you have reflected on how to grow your passion in the last 30 days? Put your hands up. That, not a lot. But I want to stop by saying, at this point, it's all right, because I think that requires purposeful engagement. Sometimes as you teach and you walk the classroom space and wherever you are, you have to remember those educators who allowed you to see that passion was important. There are many educators I've come across, but two stand out for me as good educators. Dr. Joseph Smichael, now deceased. And what I like about Dr. Smichael was the fact that she had the ability to motivate her students. I remember a few years ago when I was in Teachers College, not a few years ago, decades ago. When I was in Teachers College, I remember Dr. Smichael going beyond the call of duty. She had designed extra lessons for us to attend after the school day had completed to ensure we qualified to teach. And boy, I did value those lessons. On reflection, one day, Dr. Smichael reprimanded me. She said to me, I heard your name being called on the football field when you should have been into my class, should have been in my class. She said, Rohan Jawala, you must know if you're here to play football or to attend school. She had the passion to realign me with what I needed to do. However, I still blame those boys for shouting out my name on the soccer field when I told them, listen, I don't want Dr. Smichael to hear. They consistently shouted my voice, shouted my name out. In looking at passion, I want to recall another. I want to recall another person, Dr. Miss Brenda Atkins. Miss Brenda Atkins had the ability to teach in such a way that I've never seen before. I was in her class at one point. And I realized that she could hold an audience. She was teaching about the Frome riots. And I'm sure you know about the riots that happened in Frome. And she was able to allow these students to move in such a way that I've never seen before. And let me tell you, these students all had special education needs. She started by saying and moving to the rhythm. And if you could get into that rhythm, that would be fine. And she started singing the song, "We will follow Bustamante, we will follow Bustamante, we will follow Bustamante till we die." And the students with special needs were moving. And she did it. "We will follow Bustamante, we will follow Bustamante, we will follow Bustamante till we die." I've never heard that song before, but it still echoes in my brain. "We will follow Bustamante till we die." And the students with special needs were moving. And Miss Atkins stopped, held her hand up and said to them, "Children," all of a sudden, there were the policemen. The policemen stopped Buster in his track. And they took their guns out. And she told the students that when they took their guns out, Buster said, what did Buster say? What did Buster say? I'm not hearing. "Shoot me and let my people go." Say that. "Shoot me and let my people go." Please don't shoot me, but you know what I mean. All right. And when Buster said that, Miss Atkins, repeating those words, stopped the students and asked the students the critical question. She said, "Students, what do you think happened to Buster?" What do you think the students said? "They shot him." One said, "Them kill Buster, miss." And another said, "Yes, miss, them shoot the people, them and kill them off, miss." And Miss Atkins laughed. She laughed and stamped her feet. And then she said, "Students, when Buster looked around to see his people, what do you think happened? They all run gone." So sometimes when you're passionate, you can take people on a journey. You can let them understand where you're going. So it is fitting that we reflect on this day. It is fitting that we represent the thoughts of educators who have gone before, because their passion will lead us. It was not a passion to destroy. It was a passion to elevate. It was a passion that you could follow them to the end and know that you're learning something from them. You know, sometimes when the passion hurts and they see you going astray and they align you, you have to say, "I'm really sorry, miss, but it's all about getting the best from you." So let us reflect on those who have gone before. So as you discover, maintain, and grow your passion, you need to consider those educators who set the foundation for us so we can follow them. Next slide, please. And here's another question for reflection. How can you really evaluate yourself to discover yourself in this time? You have to reflect. And that goes back to the point of reflecting on those who have gone before and those who have left a legacy for us to really continue the journey. Now, this story is a story that you should listen to. I do hear a little chatter at the back, so I'm hoping that everything is all right around there. Now, this story is somewhat very precious to me, because sometimes you feel that you have a passion, but sometimes you realize that your passion is under attack. Have you felt as if your passion is under attack? Say yes. I have felt that. Now, this story is one time, tells about one time when my passion was under attack. You see, I had to travel from where I live in Montego Bay to Savlamar, from Savlamar to Santa Cruz, from Santa Cruz to Malvern. It was a long trip to Bethlehem Teachers College. Long. On one of my times when I returned to Montego Bay, I was greeted by a fellow Montegonian after coming off the bus. This fellow Montegonian thought it was okay to say this, "Ruan Joala, you know, stop study." I was so shocked. Immediately, I went into the defense. I said to her, "I am not studying. I'm training to be a policeman. I'm coming from police training school." At that point, I told her that because I did not want her to spread my news to the fellow Montegonians who were in the parish, who were in Sam Sharp Square. I had denied the profession. I had betrayed the profession by saying that. But I use this context to let you understand that there are some individuals out there who will try to depress your passion. They will try, when they see you going on with something, to say to you, "Listen, I don't know what you're trying to do. Leave it. Don't leave it. Continue with it. Make sure you're pressing on." My mother-in-law would say, and she often said, "Some people are dream killers." Do you have any dream killers? You know any dream killers? I say, if you know any dream killers. Well, dream killers seem to have been put on this earth to do one thing: to deflate you, to ensure that you don't succeed, to ensure that you are burnt out, and not to put you to the level that you want to be. So when you see a dream killer, walk far. Walk far, because dream killers will deflate you. They'll put you down to the ground, and then you wonder why you started the journey to become an educator to ensure that Jamaica becomes a better place. Dream killers. So in order to move on, it might be necessary to leave some people out of your passion. And I want to say this because it's important. You see, when you have a passion burning, and you have something that you realize that you're good at, sometimes shut your mouth. You agree with me? I have seen where educators have come to me to ask me about a situation or a thing or whatever, and when I look, the same thing I gave and I articulated it is the same document presenting to me without the recognizing of my work. So what I'm saying is, share what is necessary. In the sense, as you share, don't let others take your passion away. And that it cannot work, because a passion is something that is enduring. It's consistent. So put it this way. If you're working in a school and your principal says to you or says to someone, "I don't want you to look at that anymore. Focus on that." And you have a burning desire that you're looking at something else, continue to do your stuff. Do the work, but maintain both. Next slide, please. Now, here we are. The role of technology in shaping your passion. I want to say that when I went to Bethlehem Teachers College, the only thing they had was an overhead projector. And if we were lucky enough, you'd see the television with a video recorder. Those were the days, and how things have changed. It has changed to the point that now we're talking about ChatGPT. And let me ask educators today, do you know what have you heard about ChatGPT? Put your hands up. Have you used it? Confession? Confession? All right. So what I'm saying, within the context of ChatGPT and other AI systems, I'm going to say to you educators, if you are not using it, you're going to be left behind. If you're not using the technology, you are going to be a teacher that is just a normal teacher. And if you're using ChatGPT in a manner just as curiosity and you're not thinking critically as you use it, you're just ordinary. So I'm saying to you, educators, use the technology. Use it well. And as I move forward, I want to kind of share some ideas of what you can do to embrace your passion as it relates to technology. Next slide, please. Now, a lot of learning is taking place. You have so much to learn from. There's Coursera. There are so many areas that you can use technology to embrace yourself. Today, yes, we are having professional development here, but there are so many other places you can get professional development that will strengthen your ability to teach. It will guide you to the place that you network with others, which is going to be so important. Because these spaces allow for you to get the state of the art information. If you want to know about ChatGPT and other AI systems, yes, you can Google it. But if you do a course, it aligns your thoughts to what truly you need to use to develop your passion. Next slide, please. Now, I want to ask a question. How many of you really have time to develop your passion? If you have time to develop your passion, put your hands up. If you do not have enough time to develop your passion, push your hand up. Now, very good. I want you to be able, at this point, to think. Think about how technology can help you to reduce some of your administrative tasks. All right? It can reduce it. You know you have certain tasks that you can do, you need to do, but you need to use technology. And the government needs to realize that. The government needs to really invest into technology so you can have that extra time to go after what you do best, teaching. When I went to Florida and I started teaching, a friend of mine said to me, Rowan Jawala, if you ever fail a student, you're going to have a lot of paperwork. You know what I chose? If I fail the student, it means a lot of form filling out. But if I pass the student, I have nothing to do. What do you think my options were? To do what? Well, I won't tell you my decision because it might sound, you won't believe me anyway. All right? So what I'm saying is, use the technology out there to guide your pathway. Next slide, please. If you are passionate about constructing and being creative, you have to think out of the box. There are so many tools that you can use. For example, one individual say, who needs school when you have YouTube? That's ridiculous. You still need a formal education. But as creative thinkers and passionate educators, you can use the technology out there to drive your passion. Whether you're passionate about your subject area or passionate about any other area, the universe is a platform that you can learn from. There's YouTube, there's TEDx, TED Education, there is also Khan Academy that you can use. There's so many things that are out there that you can use. So my thing is, use it well. And these slides will be available for you to use. Next slide, please. Now, this is a point that sometimes it will get to you. How many of you feel burnt out sometimes? All the time. You feel as if you can't continue. You're marking papers on Sunday when you should be having family dinner and that sort of thing. It will happen. And Saturdays too. But what I want to say to you at this point is that there are many apps out there, and I'm going to give you a list of all of this. There are many apps out there that you can take your time to relax. Have you gotten a Fitbit or a smartwatch yet? If you haven't, That's a nice Christmas present. You can check your steps. It tells you when to get up. And you can use the technology to enhance yourself. But as we say, if you are burnt out and you're feeling down, it's going to be impossible to drive that passion. So you have to think about your well-being. And there are some sites that I've listed also in my collection that I'll share that you can go to and meet and have connections with fellow individuals like yourself who will elevate you. You should also understand the need to connect with people who will be there to support you. You need to connect yourself with thought leaders. A thought leader is someone who knows about the area you're researching or teaching and will be there to give you information. There are thought leaders. How many of you are on LinkedIn? Put your hands up. How many of you check your LinkedIn at least once or twice a week? I check my LinkedIn every day, someone said, right? I heard that. I check my LinkedIn every day. But it gives you information that you might be missing out on your content area. Next slide, please. Now, I want to share this because I think your passion has to be documented. I am not the YouTuber who believes in so-so-so-so. I'm not going to broadcast the latest news as it relates to how many people got murdered. I'm not going to redesign anything that reminds me of Politrix Watch or whatever. I am passionate about delivering content. I am passionate about educating others. So when I started my YouTube channel, it was never about money. And if you think I've made money, put your hands up. No, I have not made money. I'm still, YouTube only pays you out when you make $100. I'm not there yet. However, feel free to subscribe to my channel. Put me there, all right? So what I'm saying is the desire to create content was there for me, and I developed that content, and with that content, I'm able to hold a place for my work. How many of you teachers have YouTube channels? Yes, I don't see a lot, but every educator in this space should have a YouTube channel with their course content and areas that they have taught the best. If you agree, say yes. Yes, and if you want help in setting up that YouTube channel, I will help you. If you want to collaborate, I will help you. But getting the content out there is the first place that you can show your passion. So after several years, I still have 2,500 subscribers, and I'm producing content on a weekly basis. Next slide, please. Now, I'm sharing this link with you, and we can go to the next slide. And this is the same as I showed you above, but this is, you can scan and have it. This site actually has all the resources I've collected that drive my passion. If you want to know about VR, it's there, latest news. If you want to know about having free courses that you can do, it's on my Padlet. If you want to know about self-care, it's right there. You can have access to this. And of course, it is free, and you can create your own passion site that you can embrace your passion of what you want to do. So the technology is out there that can drive your passion, but you have to create time. When I was writing my book, I dedicated 1 hour every night for the past year or so, and it got me to the point where I was able to produce that book. Next slide, please. And with my passion, I wanted to share it with the world. Passion does not reside by yourself. You have to share it. Something that you love, something that you want to pass on. So I've created roughly 26 LinkedIn articles, co-authored some with my fellow colleagues. And a lot of people have contacted me via my LinkedIn pathway. So don't think it's a hard work. No, it's not. Take time to develop yourself. Next slide, please. Now, this one is my latest project. I am very concerned. Remember, I started off by talking about passion. Passion is driven by several factors. One, in which you want to address something that's happening in the world. And I see where AI is good, but I also see where AI can create problems. AI can damage us in such a way that it needs to be regulated. Do our children know about AI in this country and the Caribbean to the extent that they can address certain things? The answer is no. So I've created a course, and this course is going to be designed, and it's going to be free for individuals in the Caribbean. It's going to teach children the ethical views regarding AI. It's called AI Explorers. Adults, you can join in because it's going to ask some critical questions about AI. I'm also designing a course, I can't tell you much about that one, that's going to be targeting another population that they need to understand the ramifications of AI. We need to understand how to navigate. Next slide, please. And as they go through, they will talk about the future of AI and so many things in that level. Next slide, thank you. And at the end, students who complete this course will be given an AI certificate. These are some ways that I'm pushing my passion out there. You don't have to start as big, but you can take a little element and you can make your passion be felt. Because the bottom line is, passion is continuous. Next slide, please. Next slide. And if we can click on that link, that would be nice. If we could click on that link, that would be good for me. It should take you to a site. If you're hooked up to the internet, are you hooked up to the internet? Okay. Now, this is actually a CSI virtual reality photograph that I did. I've been passionate about VR since 2015. And although people said to me, I'm taking it over, I've never lost sight. So if we click on that link, it should take it directly into the site. We can move the pointer around. It's a VR stuff. And what happens is that when that opens, it's opening now, I think. You can move it around with your pointer. Yes, you can see it as 360. And if you look carefully, point it to the ground so they can see. Further around, further around, further around, further around. It's me. I'm dead. But the essence of this was that a faculty member wanted to create a scene that would show 360 for a CSI class in an undergraduate class. You have so many things that, this app is free. You have so many things that you can push your passion with. So I'm saying to you at this point in time, whatever you desire, you can achieve. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. 1 second, okay. Thanks, you had to close that one. So as we're thinking about that, and we're thinking about our passion, we have to understand one thing. And I want you to reflect, do a little reflection for me. Next, 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 next. No, I've shared my passion with the world, so these are some activities I'll have over another couple months. Next slide, please. And I want us to really reflect as I come to conclude. And these are the questions that I really want us to reflect on. Next slide, please. Next slide. I like this one, because I think it talks about Shelley Ann Fraser winning the recent award. Let's give her a clap. Shelley Ann, slide, please. Now I see there's no barrier when it comes onto your passion and your calling, as time honors your greatness. Time will honor your greatness. Say, time will honor my greatness. Time will honor my greatness. You've started at a point, but in the end, when people and students around you see you, they'll remember, because time has honored your greatness. So as we reflect on the last slide, here it is. The other one, I think you went too fast. Okay, that's a thank you. All right, I want to say, I had another slide that I wanted you to reflect on a few things. And the first was, have you in this session examined your passion today? If so, put your hands up. You have examined your passion. You know where you want to go after this. Put your hands up. Because I want you to understand that passion is not static. It does not sit here, but it sits here to be extended out there. I want to say, before I wrap up, has anyone been able to write a list of points from this session that they're going to be taking away? Put your hands up. First person to stand. I saw that table and I saw someone here. First person to stand and come to the front. Don't run. Just come to the front, please. Two persons, come to the front if you have your main points. I want to see the points. I want to see the points because you're going to get something this morning. I'm like school teacher today, you see? Ladies and gentlemen, I have been impressed. The notes that were taken, give them a clap, please. On this note, I want to end by saying, burn your passion, continue burning the light, continue moving on, because remember, you will be remembered for your passion and your goodness. Thanks for listening.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Jawala, and thank you, audience. Now, I have a question for Dr. Jawala, and I have a question for the audience, and I'm hoping that you will not respond. Before I get to the question, many of you were answering when Dr. Jawala asked you what you wanted to do after this. If your answer is go to the beach, you are disqualified. So the question for the audience. Yes. The question for the audience. I recognize we identified others who are dream killers. The question is, are you a dream killer? Do you take notes of all the errors children made from seventh grade so they can't graduate in grade 11? somebody else. And I want to ask of Dr. Jawala if he received a reply from the Shortwood Teachers College. We recognize that we are joined by Mr. Everett Riley, Senior Education Officer in Region 4. We thank you for gracing us with your presence, Mr. Riley, and we appreciate it. I'm going to invite Mr. Mark Smith to express gratitude to Mr. Jawala and invite in the same breath our beautiful students from Revival Primary who will give us the item right after. Mr. Smith.
Thank you so much. Dr. Chahal, can you join me here, please? Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Come on, we're thinking good morning. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, we have just been treated to an awesome presentation by Dr. Rohan Jawala. Dr. Jawala, it has been a pleasure listening intently to you sharing about how we go about stirring our passion. And it's important for us to understand as educators that the challenges are real in the classroom. And if we're not careful, as Dr. Jawala shared with us, we can suffer from burnout. It must be our imperative to use our passion, as he has stated in his presentation, to be able to navigate those difficulties and challenges. And so on behalf of all our colleagues here, I wish to give this a small token of our appreciation for what I believe is a presentation that was timely, a presentation that, of course, I hope would have stirred something within us, and most importantly, led us to our passions. Thank you so much, Dr. Bless you.
Colleagues all, while we get ready for the performance, like you, I heard for the first time today the concept of XR. Let me see the hands of those who knew what XR was. So I went to my favorite teaching tool, Google. And Google said XR is the acronym for extended reality. And it is an umbrella term encapsulating augmented reality, virtual reality, mixed reality, and everything in between. Now that is enlightening. Revival.
Pleasant morning, everyone. Okay, so the Revival Primary School Performing Arts team will be doing two items for you. One is a speech written by our guidance counselor, Ms. Tony Barrett, and myself, Sheena Reed. It's entitled Bridging the Gap, after which they'll be doing a dance called Made Away. Please give them a round of applause.
Up your book and you will succeed. With all literacy, where can grow. Reading and writing helps me to grow. Reading and writing helps me to grow. Every child can learn, every child must learn. The literacy fire in my heart just a burn. The more you are read, the more you are get.
Nobody can say.
But illiterate.
Nobody can say.
But illiterate.
Nobody can say.
But illiterate. Bridging the gap, unlocking the future. Big smart mind, smart like computer. Reading and writing, spelling and reciting. Doing literacy is all exciting.
Today I'm a leader, what will you be?
Open your eyes, come on, look and see. The future is ours if we believe. Let's work hard so we can achieve. Let's work hard so we can achieve. Let's work hard so we can achieve. Bridging the gap, unlocking the future. Big smart mind, smart like computer. Reading and writing, spelling and reciting. Doing literacy is all exciting.
Literacy means I can read.
Bridging the gap, unlocking the future.
Literacy means I can write.
Bridging the gap, unlocking the future.
Literacy means I can achieve.
Bridging the gap, unlocking the future. Big smart mind, smart like computer. Reading and writing, spelling and reciting. Doing literacy is all exciting. Doing literacy is all
Yeah.
We must admit that had we continued without receiving that rendition from revival, this experience would have been subpar. Let's give them another round of applause. All good things must come to an end so that better things may begin. At this time, we invite our president-elect, Mr. Leighton Johnson, to bring our session to an end. Mr. Johnson.
Madam President, immediate past President, Mr. Smith, Dr. Nicely, other specially invited guests in our company this morning. Good morning. Good morning, everybody. As we express gratitude, we must never forget that the highest appreciation is not in the utterances of words alone, but we must live them. We must stand true to them. This morning, I use this opportunity to thank our able host, the DSG, Mr. Clayton Hall, for the way in which he navigated this morning's function. He, with his usual style and finesse, with his anecdotes and wit, kept this program alive. We thank you, sir. To the members of the Professional Development and Advancement and Teacher Welfare Committee, who played a dual role in that of invoking the presence of the Lord and ably coordinating the activities of today. We are eternally grateful to Dr. Chin and her team for the execution of this program. To you, Dr. Nicely, and Madam President, who graced us with their usual wise words of greetings. Your words added just a little more importance to our morning. We thank you for being here with us. To Dr. Jawala, who again reminded us about the importance of passion, the starting point, growing passion, and other nuggets of passion. To you, sir, we are grateful that you have chosen to spend your time and morning with us. We are grateful to you. The Revival Primary School and their teacher, indeed, bridging the gap, unlocking the future, they are smart like computers, and of course, indicating that the Lord continues to make a way for all of us. We say thank you for gracing us with your presence and demonstrating the skills and talents of our students. Ladies and gentlemen, as this day has been carefully crafted for the professional development of all of us, I ask that we enjoy every bit of it. The best is still yet to come. Enjoy this Professional Development Day. Thank you.
Thank you, colleagues. We are now bringing this session to a close. Our ed table. Our ed table, you may now be excused. Thank you kindly. I now invite Mrs. Melissa Matheson to take over the next activity while I bid you a warm goodbye. I am certain that you had a warm welcome. We may consider giving you fans the next time around.
Continue with our first plenary. So the opening session was the first leg of the race, and I am doing the second leg of the race, and I see a lot of people smiling, and that's good. Despite the heat, yes, we are here for a good day. No matter what, I just did the first leg. So our first plenary will be finding joy in the classroom. There are many times we are here, but we're not having the joy. So like you start out and we're going well. Now that we are coming to the end of the school year, it's the third term, summer is on us, lad. Can't wait for school done, man. But we still need the joy. So we're looking at finding joy in the classroom, effective strategies to boost your passion in teaching. Now, our presenter this morning is Mrs. Aniona Jones, principal of the Marcus Garvey High School. She is from St. Anne. No, her school is in. How many persons from here are in St. Anne? Sound louder, man. The presenter coming from your parish. Persons from St. Anne, load up the place. Thank you. All right, come back to regular thing. During her tenure, which began in August 2018, she continued the transformation work at the institution. Now, to get the details, it's in the booklet. She was very specific. Don't read the entire thing. So, I invite to the podium our presenter, Mrs. Aniona Jones. Please give her a round of applause. Do better than that, man. Yes, welcome.
Distinguished guests all, pleasant morning. Listen, when I don't do that, and I say I'm going to wear my prettiest jacket this morning.
Yes,
thank you. Anybody else here thinks that they have an abusive relationship with education? And I can't tell me say me one? You never wonder why you stay. Especially after you get two big lick and one black eye and one bruised ribs. And you wonder why you stay. I said to Dr. Chin, you're lucky me love you, you know, because me no feel like some me the right person for do that presentation, because me no really sure me love this teaching thing. She said, and you know, I think you're the best person to do it, because anybody ever write their resignation letter on a weekly, monthly, biannual basis? Listen, the reality is, if it's somebody who don't want to come up here and to prove how intellectually dexterous they are, we could do that too, because we have the words them. What do we get dictionary from primary school? Don't. If that is what you wanted, I would have been the absolutely wrongest person. But if you want us to have a real conversation, a hot conversation today, honest, open, and transparent, can we do that?
Yes.
At least for a few minutes.
Yes.
Good. I am Aniona Jones, and I'm in an abusive relationship with education. It's been a 23-year relationship, and I think we should have gotten divorced a long time ago, but I am still in it. I've given birth to many children, had the pleasure of seeing grandchildren, you know, those things that you give birth to in your students, and you see them come to fruition. I've had that pleasure, but now I'm wondering, him no look so cute again, him sweet papa nose I get bigger, the eyes are used to mesmerize me, just look like them, have matter in them, I don't like you. But this morning, I want us to start where I am starting. All I'm going to do is lay myself vulnerable today and hope you understand where I am. I'm struggling to find my joy. I'm struggling to retain my passion. I have options because I'm a teacher. I create everything else, so that is not the issue. Come on now. We could be a doctor, but we chose to teach the scientists because we create doctors. We could have been a lawyer, but we chose to teach law to create lawyers. We are the beginning and the end of everything else. Nothing exists except through us. So me no ask people why me exist. Me just cut my eye and tell them, say, you wouldn't dare if I'm not for me, so next. But I'm struggling to find my joy. And as I'm struggling to find my joy, I came across this little story. And it's a story of a man who was in India. And he's traveling through this village in India. And he sees these huge elephants. I don't know if you've ever had the pleasure of seeing an elephant in real life. But they're big for true. They're big, 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 big. And here are the elephants that are tethered by a very tiny rope. And he looks at the elephants. He said, but there's something that big for true. How is it that these huge, majestic animals are being kept in place by a very tiny rope? And so curious as he is, he went over to a little farmer who's under a tree watching the elephants. And he asks him, how is it that these huge animals are being tethered by this tiny rope? The man looked at him and he said, it's very simple. When they were small elephants, we tie them on the rear leg and we drive a stake in the ground. When they are that size, it is sufficient to hold them in place. And because they are young, they are youthful, they pull against the rope. Now, so you go. You test boundaries when you're young as a teacher. You want to try everything. And somebody told you, no. You're nothing. You think you'll get promotion? You stay there one kiss up to the principal. And if you have a reputation like mine for being disgusting and terrible, that's why I tell my teachers, I say, anything on the ear about me are true. Come and I defend myself to you ever. No good to your work. They're held in place. As they push against this rope, they're held firmly in place. Because when your development is that size, a tiny rope can hold you in place. And as they grow, they learn. This rope keeps me right here. How many of us, big, huge elephants, formidable creatures, because you must be, you're a teacher, are held in place by some tiny things that were said to us way back when. And you know you chat too much. Your forehead biggie, and that's true. I mean, my forehead are almost the size of one paper. Look then. For real, it big for true. You're blacky, your head dry. Some things that were said to you when you were really, really tiny, and you thought you got over them, until you stand on a podium and you realize everybody here is going to criticize my elocution, my pronunciation, my word choice, whether or not I paint effective word pictures, modulate my voice, or have an impact. And some people are coming at this session like, oh, we got church. You see, everybody go to church for the words, you know. If you drop out of the pastor's mouth, for take it beat people. Because the sermon is never for us. The sermon is never for us. What are the things that keep you in place? What are those things? So during COVID, when I almost lost my mind, I played one song for 2 years. And I'm going to invite you to stand. Share with me that thing that kept me. And listen, I wasn't even christened. So I'm not going to profess to be a Christian. But I don't debate if God is real, because he's proven himself over and over and over. And God is not waiting on me to get baptized to exist and be real. And this song kept me going all through COVID. When them tell me say the pitney them can't learn. When I'm me one on the call. When the parents them make me want to commit mass homicide. You know this song? This kept me going when nothing else don't make no sense. Oh no! All I require for life. I know who I am. Called for to show His excellence. All I require for life God has given me. I know who I am. Anybody else know who you are? Sing it like you believe it. I live a life of favor. Thank you so much. When everybody say can't happen, Marcus never allowed children to have a cell phone. And them call me Thursday, say Miss Jones, lock down the school. And my teachers Monday morning start teach barbering by WhatsApp. That's why I don't believe in begging them for a dollar. I'm not asking you if teachers are miracle workers. How do you teach plumbing? By text message. And when everything don't make no sense, I said, God, let me tell you something. You know, say, me, you have some problems. Maybe you have more problems with me than me with you. But you get what I'm trying to say. Of all the times I could have been born, thank you, I'm not slavery still. Because I know I wouldn't live too long. Why you have to make me born now? And the song started playing on the radio. And I pulled over at Drax Hall. I say, you see, you're not easy. You're not easy, you know. And you're a chosen person. How do you lead a school in the middle of a pandemic? How you teach a class? How you deal with these children? You have a problem with your life? Take it up with God. He made a decision that you were going to be born right now for a time such as this. So you see, when you feel like you're not enough, turn on the music, I say. I am chosen for a time such as this. God is not a comedian. It is not His job to give you no whole heap of joke. True life. No. But there's a thing called peace that surpasseth all understanding, because laughing is fleeting, but joy lasts even while you cry. There is still something in your belly button that says, I am chosen for this. I am the one that is to cry in this moment for this. And the day that you lose it, that is when all of the people them little foolishness in your ears start to make sense. So today we're going to talk about a few things really quickly. We're going to be looking at, why do we teach? You see, if you leave here today and you don't know why you're still in this relationship, leave. I'm sorry, I'm telling us if it's the politically correct, and I'm me the one there. I'm a surgeon, not a nurse. Me the one will tell us you have cancer, you need surgery, or you're going to die. And we're going to go in and take it out. And I'm going to try to make sure you have the best nurse possible. But somebody has to do the surgery, and it's going to be painful. Not true. Why are you still here? You get up every day and complain about a choice that you make. Why are you still here? And it's okay to say, all I know is teaching. My degree is in environmental studies with ecotourism. I have a degree in biology and physics. Me never do none of that something yet. So there's no way I can go into another industry at 42 years old and think I'm going to be in a management position. Me have to start from scratch again. Me not mentally prepared for white people tell me about my parents. Me rather a black Jamaican child tell me about my parents. Me call you in your office. Me tell you something. Them carry me go to court. I'm going to cry to the judge and say, judge me? I would have never. I'm mentally prepared for that problem then. I'm not prepared to be a second-class citizen in another country. I'm not prepared for it. Some people can do it because they're braver than me. I'm not mentally prepared yet. May I talk the truth? I'm speaking my truth. I'm speaking my truth. My teacher them tell me every day, you ain't done. And it's all right. Because if a pitney roll up on me, me know me have 119 strong. My gang big. I'm not sure that 119 away with a mass shooting, how it going to work. I've got hope so I click down for one away. I'm not mentally prepared. So I stay in teaching for a number of different reasons. Not all of it is because I love it. Some of it is because I'm just not brave enough to start over. Am I reality that? So why do we teach? You have to sit down and talk about the relationships. Some of us, we're trying to hold on to friends that are keeping us at the bottom of the hill because we know some friends don't have the aptitude to rise with us because they might get oxygen sickness and faint, and we don't want to leave them behind. Not everybody can withstand the elevation that is the calling on your spirit, but you refuse to let them go. And the truth, the higher up my climb, the less friends I have, the more fake ones roll up, but the less true ones. And the truth, because people are my friend and tell me what them think me want here, come here the principal. That's why I'm going to deal with people I'm running too fast. Next one, rethink the norm. What was normal, not normal again. You see, you are going to tell us, you must call them, they, them, it was, or between, because, but, and, or, the long list. What is normal anymore? Maybe how you feel is the new normal, and you have to go live with it. But what is that new norm? And the last one. Let me tell you something. My daddy tell me one little thing as we move to the next slide. My daddy said, if you couldn't keep your secret, why you feel like nobody else could have keep it? If you can't put you first, then a who going to put you first? Yeah, and the reality. So we talk about these things today, and we're going to keep it rolling quickly. All of these things you have to think about today. Because teaching is a pyramid. 25,000 teachers, and the profession is a pyramid. Who is at the top? One of those appears, because we have about three of them there. That's how you go. The last count, or three, four, two. And on my business, they're not upon my payroll. Next. So teaching is a pyramid. You're coming at the bottom, and it gets increasingly smaller as you go up. Don't. Why some of us sitting there don't realize you're coming as a classroom teacher and will retire as a classroom teacher? Why is your joy dependent on something that you can't control but you can influence? None of us are mentally prepared for leave after 40 years as a classroom teacher. So you start to get bitter because your dreams aren't met. Your expectations are what cause your disappointment. The reality is, no far away, I go come in as teacher and retire as a teacher. So why are you still in it? I am 42 years old. I've been a principal in Jamaica for 5 years. Me not for do nothing. Me can retire at the first point of the scale. I should know because them take it cost me last week, so my salary is the problem. I said, okay. Me the only person here who say fail in my appraisal every single year until I'm 65. I truth. Are the truth. Think about it. I don't get an increment either. If I fail my appraisal. And there are only six things on my appraisal that have to do with Aniona. Everything else, don't. If the garbage is sorted, I don't get that point. Did you know that? If a teacher is late, I fail my appraisal. Because my job is to make sure you come to work on time, plan your lessons on time, go to classes on time, and that all 1,654 children, when we never go a Jubilee, go clap and I make monkey face for, learn. So why are you still in it? Everybody talk about the what they do. I write lesson plan, I come to school, I meet with parents, and da-da-da. How do I do it? I go online, I use AI, da-da. Nobody's really talking about why do we teach? Why does your school exist? Why is the routine the way it is? The why is what does not change. The what will change. New technology, how change. New regulation, what changes. But the why teachers exist have not changed. From Eve said to Adam, you want peace on my lunch? It has not changed. Why we teach is because nothing else exists except through a teacher. That's it. That's it. So why do we teach? Tell me what you see. ego holding you down. But we don't have that, miss. We're right. You never know. Teachers are not allowed to be wrong. We are right. Thank you, my sweetheart. If you don't let go of your ego, you cannot grow in education. If you focus on the how something is said, you miss the what. And it's just the reality. So if you think about school, like God being the greatest teacher who ever lived, God has a curriculum for your life. He has a lesson plan. He has certain experiences that he allows you to have. He may allow you to get learn some things. And like any great teacher, when you want to know if you learn the lesson, what do you do? Like me tell one teacher the other day, Miss Jones, I know you don't like me. I say, Miss, I really don't think about you long enough. Like you're not like you. God, no. I really don't. Because I'm too busy thinking about, oh, I'm going to fix the staff room for you to chat me. Some of we live our teaching career like our Pitney Girls school. Them run at the back of look, man. Them look on the girl's shoes. The teacher lean. This one, that. And we not learn what God tried to teach me yet. You know, did you ever think that in order to be Superman, Anyona Jones needed to be your Lex Luthor? Every hero needs a villain. For some people, I am going to be the villain in your life. You need a nemesis to be great. I am a principal. I'm not a comedian. If me do want to make everybody happy, I'm going to sell drugs. That is not my job. My job is to make you great. My job is to stress you out until you're amazing. My job is to make sure that all when me do what me do, God teach you. So you see the one day, learn how to see people and leave them alone because they have nothing to do with you. Walk your path and your journey. Why are you in teaching? Who do you need to be in order to survive? Let go. Run your race like the horses of Caymanas. Put on your blinders and stop. Watch me. God is going to give you a test to see if you learn the lesson. God is going to give you a... Go pass the test, God. The receipt, not pretty. The receipt is not pretty. Let it go. Let it go. So that you can grow. That is your job. Let it go. Mind your own business. Put yourself first. Learn the lesson that God is trying to teach you. Go ahead. It's all about learning. And trust me, it's not a social club, so it's not about learning how to make friends with your colleagues. The staff rooms are some of the most toxic places in school. Better go sit down in the bathroom. It's some of the most toxic places. It is where you get the rope on your ankle. Go with the Pitney them. Because the truth of the matter is the children are not the problem. You want to control them all the time. And those who can't control, write it up and escort them into another environment that is better suited for their holistic development. Because we don't kick students. No, that is abuse. We don't do that. Unless you get the children teaching each other, you're doing the bulk of the work. There's a book I want you to read, Never Work Harder Than Your Students, by Dr. Robin Jackson. The whole of we in your books, depending on what we out, and then them get all of the joy and we get all of the work. Never work harder than your students. You have to get them to the point where they can teach each other. That is when you're really teaching. All this lecture, discussion, audio, visual, that waste of time. Except where you're starting a topic. That's what's going to burn you out. Because if you stick the whole of the unit up at the top, number one, look at it. If you lecture from now till thine kingdom come, the Pitney them are going to only remember 5%, and those are the best students. So not bother lecture too long. If you even do group discussion, is a 50-50 chance them are going to learn anything. Unless the children are doing the teaching, they're not learning. Just the reality. To all the senior teachers in the room, wave your hands on me, please. Cut it out. Expect the teachers to make mistakes. Celebrate when a teacher is brave enough to try. Your performance cannot be directly proportional to the errors. Because guess what? If I'm juggling 100 plate, 10 might drop. Some people are juggling one plate and it'll drop or broke up. Celebrate the teacher brave enough to juggle 90 plates. Because some of you can't even give them one plate with a tray glued to them hand to carry from point A to point B. Allow people to make mistakes. God is the only one that was perfect. And sometimes I wonder if he did make some people by mistake. You never wonder. Some people are wondering the same thing about me too, but I saw it go. Allow for trial and error. Start by being reasonable with yourself. Some of us have too high expectations as teachers. Everything is right or wrong, like life is a book where you're ticking an X. It is not that. It's a lot of gray areas. And your unhappiness comes because you put the standard too high for yourself and judge yourself too hard. I tell my teachers all the time, I say, you're a SWAT team. Regular police can't do it. Regular soldiers can't do it. You are the elite. It never work at primary school and them give you 100 and odd pitney we read below grade 3 because you're good like that. So hear me now. You see, 5 years, it not gonna work for them. Tell them from grade 7, say, you need 7, you need 9, you need 12. And I can get you this far if you meet me halfway. So from grade 7, some of my parents know, this is one another 6, 5 years from now, because you're saying bolt in at the blocks and feel pitney don't know which part of the stadium there. So although we're good like that, I can take you so far. At schools like mine, the children learn 3 times faster than Campion. I'm going to tell anybody, match that. Because I'm taking them from pre-primer all the way to sitting city and guilds and skills proficiency and whatever. Because my teachers are a SWAT team in education. They are the elite. So don't finance me like regular soldier. Please, thank you, Madam Minister. Don't do it. SWAT team don't get regular equipment. We don't. Be reasonable with yourself. Expect things to fail. It's a part of the learning. Make peace with it. Make peace with it. And when they think they can do it better, do like this. UWE has one of the highest failure rates and them are the brightest. Do like this. My early childhood educators in the room, big up yourself. You take the most abstract and make it real. You take this like a writing, scribbling upon the wall and make a child go, ah, b, k, ba, ah, g. You are amazing. Because them upper you, we get them with 19 subject with grade 1.5. And still can't get them for pass a bachelor's. And you take them from 0 and get them reading. Come on now. It's okay. Go for me, please. So make peace with all of that. I want you all to recognize that you are extraordinary. What happened to the... No disrespect, hotel workers. I want them to know when COVID hit. We are one of the only industry that kept it going. Same pace, same time, whole different concept. Without a hitch. Every other industry, flop. All when we couldn't spell computer. We're good like that. Eh? Come on now. Remember, me tell you something, only little abusive relationship with education still, you know. But these are some of the things I'm going to sit down and meditate on as I think about education. Reset your baseline. It's going to take us 13 years to go back to 2019. That's what the cutting edge research says. Because you have Pitney right now in a grade 1, we still don't know nothing about early childhood yet. They're not even passed through the system. So it's going to take about 13 years. Which means your expectations cannot be the same as before. It is called... No, Aniona, hold on there. You record me, don't. All right, hold on. I'm not do politically correct well, enough, but in case... Anti-favor, it is unreasonable to have everything else shift except the goalpost. Right now, me can't find the ball. So me don't know if a cricket, badminton, football, baseball, me don't know where I play. but it's going to take 13 years to reset. So business as usual is? Don't do that. Business as usual is?
Unrealistic.
And that's why you feel the way you feel. Because you're taking expectations from 2020 and applying it in a whole different universe. Are you going to make yourself mad? You are the ones making yourselves mad. Now, the children must make progress. Don't get me wrong. But at what rate, in what areas? You can't tell me, say, parents lose their money, all of these things, and yet still the curriculum big so. It's unrealistic because learning is a continuum. Reading is a continuum. That's why I find it offensive when they tell me high school students cannot read. Yes, they can. Letter identification is the start of reading. Phonemic awareness is the start of reading. If all the child can do is name the letters and sound them out, the child is reading. But at what level? So come September, every teacher will have to tell me where the children are starting, and we set a realistic expectation. So I'm going to move from letter sound to right ear so. So I'm going to move from ear so to, and your performance appraisal will be based on meeting those realistic targets. Next slide, please. Reduce your workload. I think current lesson planning is a waste of time. Now, planning is a present continuous tense, which means you have to think through start, process, end. But anybody who gives me a lesson plan that said, the teacher will, you're done. So you do not know what you're going to do until you walk in there. Tell me what the children are going to do. So why are we writing all of these lesson plans and not activity sheets? Focus on what the children will be doing. When you go in the class, if a skip you need to skip, skip. If a jump you need to jump, jump. If a sit down you need to sit down, sit down. Unfortunately, I spent 11 years in the ministry, and unlike my good friend, Mark, I am not going back. I did my time. Right, Everall? I got early parole. I'm not going back in. Yes, maybe even myself. What do you mean, so that's impossible? Listen, you don't do it. Scale back the work. Scale back the work. Half of what we're being asked to do is nothing but menial data entry work that will not impact learning. I want to be able to say, you're telling me about AI? Go AI the ministry to give me an app for that. I did not do a master's degree to punch in attendance numbers. You get an app. You have $256 million that you sent back. Build me an app. Thank you. So that we can do what only teachers can do, which is inspire ourselves. Sit on the toilet for 4 hours and tell yourself it's gonna be okay. Get up and put on your clothes and your best makeup. Cuss in the car. Drink over here. So go in front of the class and say, you guys are wonderful and amazing. And in the back of your mind, you go, oh no. Don't lose your joy. We cannot lose our joy for people who cannot do what we do. Jesus was better than you. He healed them. 10% come and say thanks. The 10% might have to be uno pan teachers day, because the next 99 now tell you no thank you. It's okay. Stop looking for thank you. Stop looking for it is good enough. They will never give you because they don't get it. So do I like education? Every second Tuesday and third Wednesday. for the rest of the time that I put on my clothes, it is called discipline. I tell myself what I'm going to feel. I talk to myself in the morning. I say, Anya, you cannot tell anybody about their parents today. You cannot lose the little work. You have to set an exact account with the one that can't take a day today. I tell myself anything I have to tell myself. I put on my clothes. When I don't feel like it, I put on the sneakers. I say, I am not talking to no uno today. I go with the children. I come home with bag juice mark and cheese trick stain, and I go to my children. Because when everything is wrong, my students make it right. We could talk and talk forever, but if you lose nothing else, don't lose that discipline. That high expectation of yourself. Our profession has gone to the dogs and it cabba cabba bad. We have become no best than the parochial mundane people and elements on the road. We are the beginning and the end of everything else. We represent the best that the world has to offer because we created it. Why are we talking like them? When did we get to the place where we fought against each other, house divided, cannot stand? What are you doing? And the more we get divided, and the weaker we get, is the more we get stressed and die. We are killing ourselves. Stop it. They need us divided. They need us against each other. Principal against teacher. Teacher against ancillary worker. Ancillary worker against admin. What are we doing? Don't you see that you have become pawns on the devil's chessboard? I am nobody's pawn. My God is a king. My God is a teacher. This is a test of the sector and we're failing. And the reset is going to kill us because the salary negotiation is coming up. And if we're divided, they have won. So you decide. May I go take two more lick for your side term? But I ask no one why I teach. I know why I teach. I worship through my work. I see God in every child and I'm blessed that God trusts me enough. I am not enough. I am inadequate. So if a perfection you look for, no look at Anyona Jones, come, I don't have that to give you. So don't watch me. Watch God who trusts you enough to give you these children. God gave you the most precious things in the world because he trusts you enough. Find joy in the trust that God has given you. Stop going to church with the come to Jesus hat, a key kalamashanda, lick down the church bench and go to work and worship. Give service to the children because that is how you serve God. Don't let them divide your school. Don't let them divide our sector. We are the most powerful elements in this country. When police can't catch them, we send a message, tell him to come to school and I'm going to reach him yard and him come. That's why they give us everything in school. That's because you're good like that. And if you weren't that good, you'd be a politician. You'd be a police officer, you'd be a lawyer, you'd be a something else. But because you're that good, you are a teacher.
Presentation up with wow. Wow. One more. Wow. You notice when we started off, I just asked for the members, the persons from St. Anne to load up the place. You notice when you finish, and put on your nice. Oh, give us a spin again. Just give us a spin.
Woo! Woo!
Yes. We had the entire room on fire. And I just went to check on the YouTube if we were live. And you were quite live. And everybody on the online platform, they're like, wow. So with that, I'll invite Miss Alcyon Pinnock to come and tell you thank you.
Can I get another wow? Water with wow? Was that presentation excellent? True or false? True or false? All right. First, I must say, I want that jacket. I love this jacket, and I need this jacket. All right. You were so straightforward. Wasn't her? Yes. And I think that the teachers appreciated that. You can tell by their reactions. You spoke truth, facts, and it is so very relevant. It is extremely relevant, I should say, to find joy in this abusive profession. And on behalf of the JTA family, I want to present this token to you and to say thanks to you for such a beautiful presentation. Can I get a wow? Thank you again.
So this is a relay, and I did the second leg, and I'll be handing over to Mr. Kemar Bailey. He's doing the third leg. And don't worry, you see the anchor? You know when you come to the anchor, and at that time, you know that relay, when champs time, everybody want the relay? So first leg, we had a good start. It's a good start. Yes. And our session we're going to end with, I'm going to give you a word. Where's Mr. Bailey? So our third, we're doing a smooth transition. And as we do this transition, I want to hear you say wow, wow. But try that again. So, wow, wow. And I hand over to Mr. Bailey. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Good morning, everyone. So, as she mentioned before, we transitioned. And before I go any further, give yourself a round of applause. You have been a wonderful audience. So, up next, this speaker, Mrs. Rosette James Smith. She graduated from Sam Sharp Teachers College in 1993 and has since worked as a teacher, guidance counselor, and administrator. She is now an associate counseling and consulting psychologist, serving in the capacity as guidance counselor at the Sam Sharp Teachers College. She also worked as an adjunct lecturer at the College of Theological and Interdisciplinary Studies, associated with the Open Bible Standard Churches of Jamaica. She is also honored to be a part of the Jamaica Teachers Association Counseling on Demand team. Rosie G, as she is more affectionately called, she finds time to inspire people in different ways through her own company, Pull Power Now, pulling people into their greater life one day at a time is what she believes in. In 2012, she was awarded the Jamaica Teachers Association R.C. Tavares Award in recognition for her outstanding service to the association. She also served as a national president for the Jamaica Association of Guidance Counselors in Education in 2003. In 2018, she was awarded the Counselor of the Year. She has also recently awarded the Prime Minister's Medal of Appreciation for her service in education. Mrs. James Smith has shared with different audiences in Jamaica, and other countries, sharing the message of hope and encouraging others that giving up is never an option. And as the presenter before would have mentioned, that teachers, that giving up is not an option. And we're teaching because, as they say, we do it for the love, we not do it for the likes. Wonderful. So put your hands together and help me welcome our next presenter, Mrs. Rosette James Smith.
Teachers come from all around, carry them work on them phone. If you say school go pop down cause them there, put down the phone, look around. Today is about you. You are important too. How many persons can relate? We check from morning about school, you check on picnic, you check on parent, you check on something else that's supposed to happen. Principal check if all teachers who said they were going to be at school are at school, and you're checking on school from start to finish. Now so, well, guess what? You need to put down the phone. And you see, because me short, I cannot stay up here, because my vision is not as good from far. The taller people have the better vision, right? So I have to come down and be among you. And today we're talking about mental health and from passion to practice. So we're going to sing that song again. And this time when I sing the part about today is about you, you're going to point to somebody and tell them, right? So ready again? You ready? And I must say that when Dr. Chin called me, I was like, really? Me? JTF function, Ellen Stills? And then guess what them do to me? Them put the international speaker right before me. The big top-down principal from Marcus Garvey. When I heard her, I said, Lord Jesus. They couldn't put me before the lady. So, but I am just standing and saying, God, I know me, are you? So if you let if me let down, are you going to shame on me? Right? So I am here standing in God's grace. But we're going to go again. Ready? Everybody ready? So come. I have a sad story to tell you. It's all about teachers come from all around, have them. Because them think school go pop down because them there. Put down the phone. Look around. Today is about you. You are important too. Tell somebody, put down the phone. Look around. Today is about you. You are important too. Tell them again. Look around. Today is about you. Now what I want you to do is to touch yourself and say, today is about me. I'm important too. Say it again. Today is about me. I'm important. I want you to touch your head. Today is about me. I'm important. Touch that part of your body where it hurts you. Today is about me. I'm important. Come, touch your body. Touch your body. It's about me. I'm important. Touch all your body parts. Some parts are afraid. I know. Today is me. I'm important too. Every part of us, we are important, and we need to know that when we come here, it is not just about the children. The topics weren't chosen for you to become now to say, you notice, is passion. And you're talking about your passion, what is important to you. So I want to ask you the question, are you in charge of your own destiny? I always ask my students, are you a puppet on a string? Are you a puppet on a string that somebody just leading you around and guiding you? There's a story of a dog on a nail. And the dog was on the nail and moaning and groaning. Moaning and groaning. And somebody asked the owner, why doesn't the dog get up off the nail? And the owner said, the nail isn't hurting him enough. The nail isn't hurting him enough. The previous speaker asked you, why are you here? But each of us, you know, you have your reason. But some of us, it's not just the job. Some of you are in some situations that you need to move, that you need to step away from. You have some friends that you need to let go of that are affecting your mental health. There are some persons in our life that we need to only apply the red button when they call our phone. What the red button say? Decline. Reject. Not accepting that call. Or we let it ring and pretend it was Flo or Digicel giving trouble. There are some persons where you let them in your ears that spoil your day. And yet because you're so nice and you're so child of God, you decide that you have to take their call. And then your day just mash up. You have to decide if you are going to put yourself first. If you are going to be successful, you have to do the things today that others are not willing to do. If you look back at history, you'll realize that the things that caused persons to be successful are things that others were not willing to do. Because guess what? If everybody was willing to do it, it wouldn't even look like success because everybody would be there. But if you want to be in the top, there are some persons that quarrel and say, look how much time they send me up for JT award and then I choose me. I look how much time they appoint people. Oh, I'm not getting no award at my school. I'm not getting no senior teacher. I'm not getting nothing. But when they say, do something extra, or when you have an idea, there are some of you have ideas that could change the education system. Some of you have ideas that could make your students better in spelling. Some of you have some books. Some of you have some business ideas. But what you do? You keep it inside. And you're there and you're saying, boy, this is something I want to do. You have the passion for it. But does it go into practice? Miles Monroe says the richest place on the earth is where? The cemetery. Can you afford for your success to end up in the cemetery? Guess what? It's time to step out of your comfort zone. If you notice, I did not do a PowerPoint, because guess what? During COVID, you see this topic, you get about 21-200 PowerPoint on mental health, don't? I couldn't think of anything that I could put on a PowerPoint that JTA hasn't already presented, or your guidance counselors at your school, or different educators or something. And I said, you know what? It's not PowerPoint day today, but guess what? If it's not PowerPoint, it's activity. So I hope you never thought that this was one of those presentations that you're going to sit down. You have to get up and you have to move, because guess what? Dr. Chinsey, I must talk about practice. And the only way I know to practice is to practice. And a lot of the things, we hear the theory, but nobody show us how to actually do it. And so today we are going to be doing it. Everybody say doing it. Doing it. We're going to be doing it. And I know some persons, their mind gone far, there. But wherever it went, that's fine. That's fine, whatever doing it. When it comes to mental health, you have to do what doing it means to you and do it good. Yes. Now, guess what? There are some persons here who, even though you are here laughing, you are here participating, stress up pop you down. Some of you are stressed. You're thinking about June and how much exam you have to go, ma. Some of you have SBAs pile up. And you're thinking about it, all sorts of things that are right there. Some of you have how much lesson plan are you going to get appraised next week? And you have to go catch up. Some of you, they register no mark board from January. And you have to go catch up and remember who come which day and what. And guess what? The e-portfolio is set up. And you have to go set up. And guess what? The reality is, for most persons, that's just a tip of the issues. Because some of you also have home things, church things, community things. Because when you are a teacher, everybody call on you. Every group you step in, the teacher must be president. Everywhere you go. I sat in a meeting at Irwin High School, and I realized that the president had resigned. And so I went to the meeting and I stay in the crowd where nobody could see me. And there are things that came up that I wanted to comment on. But me say, me not making them hear me mouth. And so I said nothing for the entire meeting. When president come up, the first person they asked, resign. And decline. The second person declined. And then they said, somebody asked me, what is your name? I said, Susan Johnson. And so Susan Jones, he said, I nominate Susan Jones. And I was there looking around like everybody else. And then somebody said, no, I nominate Rosette James Smith. And me said, and somebody else said second, and somebody else said third, and somebody else said fourth. And he said, Jesus. And then my problem is, me did promise God say anything them ask me to do, because my child never passed for Erin, and me beg me send you something to take her. You understand? So me say me now go tell him no. And so I sat there. When I said it, but I didn't say anything in the meeting, one person said, can you guess where your teacher? Miss, we know you're from Katrina Hall. Somebody else said, Miss, you taught me at Bethel. And me I said, me get chopped for that 1 year. But that's how it is with you. That's how it is, and you have the different things, but what are you going to do? Because life is 10% of what happens, and 90% of how you respond to it. And you need to make a note of that, because sometimes we forget, and we put the 90% with the what happened. The 10% is the what happened. How you respond is the 90%. So when life happens, you have some people who the man left them, and them just move on and step into another relationship. And some people, the man left them and then pop down, mash up start, wear mash up clothes, and mess up themselves and they hear now coma everything. Because guess what? There is no life without him. I cannot live without him. He was my future. He was my life. I can't move on. And there is nothing else. 10%, 90%. How you respond, the same thing that sends somebody to further their education, another person it send them to 10th floor or ward 21, depending on where you live. I don't know about the mandible, so what your mental places, Bellevue and all of those. So we need to know that there's a thin line between sanity and insanity, and you need to take care of you. Now I want us to look around. I want you to look around. I'm using my therapeutic voice. And I want you to think of five things. Look around for five things that you can see. Five things that you can see. Make a mental note of them. Five things you can see. Four things that you can hear. Four things that you can hear. Three things that you can touch. Three things that you can touch. Two things that you can smell. Two things that you can smell. And one thing, when you put your tongue out there, it might be from memory, it might be something there you can taste. There are some persons who are tasting what they had last night or what they did last night. The taste, what you can taste. Now, what do you find? Tell me what you find happens when you are looking around for the things, when you are looking for the things, what happens? Who can tell me? Who wants to share? What happens when you're looking for the information? Yes. You focus. So what happens is that for that period, you cannot focus on the problems because you are focusing on where you are. We call it mindfulness. So that's one strategy we use to just remind. Somebody might come to my office, I'm bawling on the place, I'm done. And I say, all right. Tell me, where are you? And they say, I'm in your office, miss, I'm in your office. And I say, what are you sitting on? And they look around, the chair. What are they doing? They kind of little by little getting distracted from what is happening to them. Because they focus, they might think, what is someone else? They're foolish, they say, and I say, what do you see on the wall? And they start to look around, and it distracts them from what is happening with them. Mindfulness. Sometimes you have to remind yourself where you are. Because the mind can take you some far places that are sometimes not good for you. The mind takes you back some places in history sometime that you have left. And we need to remember that one of the things that you cannot control is your past. You have no control over the past. So you need to let it remain past. Stop bringing it up back in your mind. Because that's how the mind works. Negativity comes naturally to the mind. It does not need help. But you have to take the information and reframe it. And so the mind comes and remind you. Say, remember how you went bad at high school? Tell your mind, just look at me now. Just look at me now. So don't get caught up in, I wonder if they're here, I wonder if that. It is a lesson to tell your students, even if this is happening to you now, you can turn yourself around just like me. And you can become a professional just like me. Life happens, but it does bad decisions. It's not the end of your life. So yes, you might see a video on me when I was 16. But guess what? That girl does not exist anymore. And so let us forgive the past self. We made some mistakes. Forgive that young man that used to smoke weed. Forgive him. Forgive that girl that used to go around because she needed attention and have sex with enough boy. Forgive her. Guess what? She turned her life around and became an educator. Forgive her, it's past. She can't change it. It happened. But now she is different. He is different. So don't punish the person. Mother Teresa, some of us, a lot of problems come. Mother Teresa said, Lord, I know you said you don't give me more than I can handle, but I think you have too much faith in me. Too much things. I know some persons feel overwhelmed, like the donkey in the well, and they're throwing garbage on the donkey. They want to bury the donkey, and they want to say no more, and you're just looking up and you're saying, God, I can't take no more. But that donkey, when the dirt came down and the garbage, he just started to shake it off and step on it. Some of you are absorbing too much of the situations that are happening in your life. You need to shake it off and step on it. Lord, grant me the serenity to accept the things, say it with me, that I cannot change. The courage to change the things I can. And the most important part, the wisdom to know the difference. There are some things you cannot change. So I want you to do something. Think of all the situations that you might be facing now. And thank you for being my mic star. You're so nice, right? Let me set my mic stand good. Yes, and you're going to just rub your forehead. Just rub your forehead. Rub down to the side of the ear, right down to the side of the ear, and push it under your chin. And say, I release. push it away under the chin and say, I release. And that same thing you're going to rub from the shoulders, going right down, right down. Anyway, you know there was issues, some of you, that your vagina or penis caused some issue in the past. Release it. Release it. Say, I release. I release. I release. Let it go. Let it go. Let it go. Holding it does not help. We're moving on quickly. Remember that I had a grade 4 teacher. He was legally blind. In grade 4, we didn't realize what it meant. We used to just put our bag on our back when he was beating us, and when we get the lick, we say, "Aye!" And we know he couldn't see the bag. And so when that time he was Mr. Douglas, when Mr. Douglas beat me in the back, we say, "Why? Why?" And we're not feeling a thing because we have on our knapsack. But we know him can't see the knapsack. But when I look at the same Mr. Douglas, who is now retired education officer, senior education officer, Dr. Hickswell Douglas, I say, what excuse do we have not to put our passion into practice? What excuse do we have? We look at the video with the man without arms and legs. What excuse do we have? Why are we not writing that book? Why are we not doing that thing? Sometimes you have to just breathe when the things happen. I want you to just stop. And you're going to breathe. You're not going to do this. You're going to slowly take the air in. And we're just using our nostrils. We're not using our mouth. So you're going to take the air in through your nostrils. In. And let it out. In. And let it out. In. And let it out. While you're doing it again, I want you to focus on the breath going up in your nostrils. Focus on it releasing. Focus on the breath again as it goes up. And focus on it releasing. Sometimes you just need a purposed pause to just bring you back and fresh up the mind and put you back into what you need to do. You just need to remember that life is a fight for territory. And a lot of things are competing for the space in your mind. And so you need to think about it and decide what you are going to give space. I want 5 persons to quickly come up here because I have about 3 minutes left. So I want 5 persons to quickly come. Don't all come at once. One person coming, I need 4 more, quickly. 4 more, quickly, quickly. 3 more. All right. 1, it's okay. You can come back, you can come back. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And they're asking if a male can come. All right, anyway, we have to move on because of the time. Thank you, sir. Come. All right. Now, guess what? I'm going to give you, why I don't mind the numbers, because I'm going to give you some things that you need to find. We're having a scavenger hunt. And you are going to find the list of things, and the person who can come back with all the things on the list first, I have a prize for you. But don't worry. We have something for everybody. We're going to try. Right? Some shop gave me some things, and I'm going to give them away. I hope I have enough. But the list of things, right? Because we have to do our journaling. So you want to find a journal, right? So guess what? In the interest of time, you can start moving around, right? You want to find wipes. You want to find a comb. You want to find a mirror. And you want to find a condom. So, the journal, the wipes, the comb, the mirror, the condom.
Condom.
different. If you have condom, can't help them, put up your hand, man. While we're doing that, let's listen. While we're doing that, we're going to ask the rest of you. All right. You can come back with what you have. Can come back. Can come back with what you have. All right, now guess what? Before we check them, all right? Question, what are you grateful for? Now I want you to, in 10 seconds, write down as many things as you can that you think you are grateful for. 10 seconds. As many things that you are grateful for. All right, time, stop. Nobody writing now. Be obedient. Who think they have the most things? But before we go to that, nobody writing now. Right? We have two, and I must teach their name. I must teach her. Who? Condom. Condom. So, as the person sharing, I didn't say that it needs to be, and I should have been spent a proper condom. And the fact is that I've been in schools where with little elastic, these have been used, sad enough, but it's the reality. But clap them. All right, so at the end, you can return the people them things them. At the end, you will come back for things, right? Now, who think they have the most things grateful for? How many you have? Six, who have more than six? 10, who has more than 10? 13, who has more than 13? Who has more than 13? Anybody has more than 13? All right, come with the 13, please come. Oh. All right, she's going to share what she's grateful for quickly.
Life, family, friends, job, peace of mind, happiness, love, trials, walking, God, eyesight, speech, mistakes.
All right, thank you. You're going to come back afterwards, right? Now, your mental health is important. And you need to know that you have to take care of it. So just as I close, I want to ask, because I hear that's playing my introduction to give me the reminder, my closing song, right? Stop dreaming about the passion that you have. You have something that you want to do. You have something that you know you want to get out. Stop thinking about it. Stop having it in your head. You need to put it into practice. Make it happen. At about two, when the first presenter asked about the YouTube channel, I was so good because some years ago I wouldn't been able to put up my hand. But now I have 4 YouTube channels. Although I'm not subscribing. But you have to put it in. You have to try. Because guess what? I do not want to live an unlived life. We have one life to live. Let us live it while we are alive. We want to make sure. So questions. What makes you feel good? What lifts you? What are you doing for fun? What do you do about the negative thoughts? How are you reframing them? What are you speaking to put life in your system? How are you preparing your passion? How are you preparing for more? Right? I want you to remember to access the unlimited power in you. I want everybody to say, it's possible. It's possible. So let me encourage you to get past your fears. Step out of your comfort zone into your greatness. Move into the things that can get you where you need to be. And the last thing that I have to say, I want to say with some drinks, right? So let me go up here so that you can see the drinks. Some of them you'll just have to trust me for it. And so, no rum cream. So guess what? Sometimes life comes at you with some things. Not so? And you have to squeeze. You feel like it just squeezing you. You know the squeeze drinks? You feel like life just squeezing you. Sometimes you have to make sure that you don't find yourself with solo. You know the solo PRJ? Because guess what? Sometimes being solo is not alone. We need people around us. And so, sometimes you have to do positive self-talk. You have to lyrics yourself. This drink is lyrics. You have to tell yourself how you're nice, how you're special. Sometimes it might take a trip to Arizona, or you might need a trip to Hawaii, or you might just want to stay in the tropics. But you need to realize that no matter what, even if you're chubby, are you sexy like Pepsi? You need to remember that you need to just say, listen what? I cool. And so, you need to remember that you are bigger than your situation. You are bigger than your circumstances. And sometimes you just need to bust a move. Or you need to just feel the magic with some sparkling wine and just enjoy life. I want everybody to just get up on your feet, and I'm going to ask the persons who won the prizes to come and choose their prizes. Thank you so much for listening. All right, so come now, everybody. I feel good from my head to my shoe. Ready? And I have a prize for the craziest dance. Come, let's move. Come on, everybody. Movement. Where's the person with the craziest dance? You see her? Mr. C must come. Congratulations. I hope you enjoy your journal. Thank you so much for having me.
Let's keep the claps going for our presenter, Mrs. Smith.
Excellent presentation. At this time, we're going to invite
Ms. Sandra Hunter to the stage to do the vote of thanks. Mrs. Smith.
going to use the lower level area. Mrs. James Smith, she did a very good job. Give her a round of applause. Yes. Mental health is indeed very important, and we really and truly appreciate the passion-filled manner in which you presented your information. Thank you. Give her another round of applause. Not because I can't dance and do all of these things. I mean, she represented well. And I must say, I plan to tell you that God is not ashamed of you. You remember her starting with that, and she was wondering about it. All right.
Thank you so much, Miss Hunter. We have one life, live it. There's a thin line between sanity and insanity. Mental health is serious business. You need to take care of you. Once again, thank you very much, Mrs. Smith. The next voice you will be hearing is that of Ethan McNamee, as he will take charge for the next session. Mr. McNamee. While we're waiting on Mr. McNamee to join us, let us enjoy the music, as we need to have a new attitude. As the presenter said, that we need to release the things that are holding us down.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I see that you're hot. This session will make you hotter. It might even make some people reach to their hottest. But never mind, there is always something to cool you down. And so, the pleasure is mine this afternoon to present to you Bishop Dr. Carla Dunbar. Dr. Dunbar is a Kingstonian by birth, but she ended up in Portland. And being in Portland, she got involved in the Church of God of Prophecy. Yes. All the prophecy members here? All right, so we know what we're talking about. And she was pastor, senior pastor for 21 years in the Church of God of Prophecy, but she ventured out into her own field by doing her own thing. And she's now Bishop Dr. Carla Dunbar, and she's the director of Carla Dunbar Ministries International, and she's the principal director of Grow Your Marriage Academy and Ministry. And she's also a family counselor. She has written several books. One, I can tell you, it is Sexcription. And the title will tell you, give you a brief synopsis of what might be in the book. If you have not yet bought that book, I implore you, I beg you, I beseech you, don't leave today without a copy. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you Dr. Sex herself, Dr. Carla Dunbar. Make her welcome.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I would have really wanted them to feed you first, because I don't know who can make love on a hungry belly. And that's what they're asking me to do. That's a very difficult and mammoth task. Right? So I'm not even enjoying it myself. But I'm going to try as best as I possibly can. So let me at this time greet the persons who I'm not seeing at the head table at this time, but the president of JTA, and just observe the protocols for those who are invited and your dignitaries that are here with you this afternoon. It's really good to be back with you, and I can tell you, teachers, I would not have missed it for the world. I really would not have missed it. Most of you would have watched me on TV just this past Monday evening, and so I'm sure you would have heard that I am recovering from a stroke. I know I don't look it, and it's not by a stroke of luck. It is by the grace of the Almighty God. So I'm certainly happy to be able to be given the privilege to share with you, because I love to promote love awareness, right? And I love to do it through theoretical dissemination, and hope, of course, that you will apply the practical for those of you who are qualified, because not all of you are, but that you'll apply the practicals later on, right? And there'll be no excuses as to that. Now we're talking about balancing love and personal life, which is what I have had to do, having not learned much acrobatics myself. But I still had to learn how to do the balancing, right? And I think it may be what has kept me this young. May I say to my colleague who presented earlier on, she reminded me of myself when I was much younger. Where is she? Did I say when I was much younger? Yes. Very, very good presentation. I particularly loved how engaging she was. Now, balancing family, balancing work and family life is one of the most common sources of stress for working adults. Really and truly is, which is why it's so good to have the presentation on mental health and keeping your mental health together. And this is more so because we're a productivity-driven society. We are. It's about how much more you can produce. And so more and more persons are finding themselves, find it hard to adequately, you know, fulfill your roles, both at home and at work. But we have to do it because we don't have a choice. So it has to be done, right? So that's one reason. And then the second reason is that persons cannot really truly find a point of balance between your careers and your families. And so one is given priority over the other. And this kind of, I call it a behavior, this kind of behavior has been associated with several dysfunctional outcomes, right? That has really affected our both our home and the industry in which we work, right? It has caused, that's been the cause of largely inefficiency at work and poor physical and mental health, as you have heard. Because when we cannot handle the stress associated with trying to balance, then the pressure is certainly on, right? And so we have to learn to work on that. So the idea of balancing may seem very daunting, especially for those of you who are not into theatrics, right? And so it's good that you have physical education teachers among you so that you can get a little bit of that going. And especially if you have bought my book, Sex Scripture, which you were implored to purchase, right? I was outside just now autographing some of them for persons who were very wise in making the investment to ensure that you capitalize on something that could be a very good investment for your life and your future. Because if you are at all engaged in a relationship, if you are married as I am, and I am going over 40 years and counting, right? And I can still attest that I do have the goods. And somebody said, my husband in particular, it pays to advertise when you have the goods. So I'm advertising to him alone right now anyway. But yes, you understand? But the truth is that in today's society, we are constantly bombarded. And I prepared a PowerPoint, which I think Travis is going to try to follow me with, if he's able to follow me. But it's really not for my benefit, but more for yours. Right? But that's exactly what is a PowerPoint. Right? So if you can look at me, and if you don't want to look at that, that's fine. You can just use technology. That's what your guest speaker, keynote speaker said this morning. Just take a picture of the slide. That's it. Don't need to write anything, because you're going to bring it home and put it into file 13. Right? So it don't make any sense. Right? But in truth, our pursuit of education and wealth, as I've heard from our keynote speaker, and success, it keeps us constantly on the move. And we tend to say that relationships matter to us, but our actions often show differently. Right? When you boil it right down to the gravy, you realize that relationships that you say matters, it really is not given the priority it deserves. So it really no matter. It's only what you're saying and not what you're really doing. Right? And so we understand that our career advancement, it takes up big chunks of our times. In studying, I know how that can be, but I was a smart studier. Because while I was enrolled and in pursuant of my degree, I ensured that I was seeking after two H's, the honors, but maintaining the keeps on my husband. So I wanted to graduate with both H's, and I have, because I learned the balance. Yes, because I want to do all of the things that it involves getting me to the place where I need to get. But in the midst of that, I want great romance. I want deepened intimacy. I want exhilarating sex. So I want everything. I want a balance of all of those things, right? So I had to ensure that I find the balance. And so I learned that it's not so much being perfect, but perfecting. And I found out that it's not so much in having the perfect balance, but in balancing. When you strive for the, when you go after the perfection, you might not attain it, and then you become disappointed. Because not all of you will be a Carla Dunbar, so don't try. There's only one of me. And the table, the assembly line that I came after, the mold has been discarded. So there's only one of me, or one of what you think I am. because a lot of persons have thoughts about who they think I am. And because I am a sex therapist, I noticed in your program that the fact that I am a marriage and family therapist was never even mentioned. What was mentioned was that I'm a sex therapist. So I think you're capitalizing on what you think is important. Right? In their book, Married to Distraction, Edward and Sue Hollowell wrote, how a person spends his or her time is often more contentious in how a couple than how a couple spends money. And this is so true, how you spend your time. And before I go too far in providing you with some things about how to find balance, let me again say, achieving perfect balance, it not possible. So leave that alone, because you won't attain to that. Right? But you can have some sort of balancing somewhere. So with that in mind, within the context of work and life relationship, how do we begin to achieve the balance? I read somewhere the French impressionistic painter Henri Matisse. He said, what I dream of, he dreams. You heard just now that you're not just to dream, but you're to ensure that your dream is a reality. So if it is that you want to give your husband, if you're a wife, and a sexual epiphany every time you copulate with them, then you have to put some work into it. If you're a husband who wants to ensure that your wife is thoroughly loved and feeling love, then you have to put some practical applications into it. If you keep it a dream, it will remain in your ideal, and that's all it will be. An ideal. You may not even get an orgasmic experience. Or you may have a wet dream. The choice is yours, really. Right? But that's what it is. And so you have to put practical application into what you really want to have. Because for many of us, work and career advancement, it takes up so much of our time. Right? And we have to figure out ways to fit our friends and our families into our schedule, along with eating and exercising and church and all of the different things that we take on to feel fulfilled. By the way, you can never be really fulfilled with those things. You're only fulfilled in Christ, knowing that you're already complete and your completeness is in Him. So don't look for it from your husband. I don't look for completeness from Mr. Dunbar. He compliments me. He doesn't complete me. Right? And because I know that I don't stress the man and give him gray hairs, right? Because I know that he can't complete me. I am a full set of emotions and a bugger only for other things. You understand? It would take him to his grave to try to complete me. So I would say to him, don't even bother try. You understand? But I know who I am, I know what I want, and I know how I can move on to it. I understand that self-care is important, which is something that was spoken about just now, right? And so once upon a time I didn't think about extreme self-care. Now I think about it. Now I have to slow down. Now I have to change my diet, because all of that would cause me to be the great woman that I am and the extraordinary lover that I have become. Right? My husband would say tricks in trade and matches boxing business. And I try to get the tricks in the trade and to ensure that I strike the matches on the box when I need to do it. Right? And so today, even though I'm by no means perfect, I take time. I make time. You will never have enough time. Everybody has the same 24 hour. I don't know if there are any of you that has 26. But the prime minister, the presidents, they have 24 hours in their day. You have to maximize upon your time to ensure that you balance yourself, right? But I take the time. I take the time away from my husband sometime if I need to do that to recalibrate myself. Because recalibrate I must. Because how else will I be able to service him and then the other person that I need to be able to affect their lives, right? So one of the things I'd say is that you have to take personal responsibility for delivering excellence in every area of your life. That spells pride. Personal responsibility in delivering excellence in every area of your life. So you can't just be a good teacher in the classroom and not be a good wife or husband when you go home. If you choose to marry, you must maintain and sustain a marriage. You have to, you have a responsibility under God to do it. And you're going to be brought into question whether or not you had done what it necessitates to ensure that the person that you made vows with, that that person is feeling loved, special, respected, and feeling like priority. Nobody entered into a relationship to be secondary. Nobody. Everybody entered into a relationship to be first. Yeah? Even if it's incoming. You know, a gentleman who brought me to the table here told me that he'll soon come back. I said, sir, don't do it here, not with me. This is not the place. Right? You may return to me if at any point you so desire. Right? But yes, everybody enters into a relationship to be first. And in your pursuit, you should not allow the person that you consider to be significant to become secondary in your life. You understand? It doesn't make any sense, because if I feel like I am not first place, then naturally I'm going to feel daunted. My efforts are going to be thwarted because it's based on how I'm feeling. And you ladies know that we run on emotions like America run on Dunkin' Donuts. Right? So our emotions is what carries us. So we need to feel love. We need to feel special. We need to feel sexy. We need to feel all of that. Our men need to feel desired. They need to feel needed. And so you have to ensure that you're doing what you're supposed to be doing to make sure that things happen. And you cannot confuse having a career with having a life. The two things are distinctly different. A career is a career. It doesn't mean you have a life. A job provided with a paycheck. But that is it. You understand? So you have to ensure that you don't confuse the two. And you're not so busy making a living that you forget to make a life. So if JTA don't bring you come to royalty and you never come, they don't pay you. You must be able to can find a way there without them bringing you. This is good that they opt to take you here. That you can have a down day, and I see them setting up some more country pants over on the other side for you to get the kind of workout and massage and whatever you need. It's good that that is happening. But you must invest in your own life to ensure that that is happening on a more consistent basis. Everything in life that is important finds a place on your schedule. So schedule your time. Schedule your beauty time. Schedule recalibrating time so that it happens. Because if you're not taking care of you, you want me to talk about sex, you would not be able to manage sex. Because sex takes a lot of energy. Even if you're doing a little cut and quint, it takes energy. Even if it's an excavate nookie, it still takes energy. Whatever it is, it's going to take some of your energy. So you have to take care of you first. You understand? You can't do a balancing act with half of yourself popped down. Your body looking good like a door that is standing up. I was about to use the word phallic, but I changed my mind, lest you think I'm talking about sex. Right? But you can't look good like a door standing up that termites have eaten out. And if they just touch you, so all you need is like a whiff, and you are gone. If you want great romance, deepened intimacy, and great sex, you have to take care of your physical self. It's important. Yeah, it's very important. You can't just be doing, oh boy, boy, the work so hard. Everybody knows they work hard. Is which work easy? Everybody know that work is hard. So you have to do what you need to do to ensure that you preserve. And you know what I found funny? How you work so hard to procure a relationship and then you're not working equally as hard to maintain it. It don't make no sense. It's counterproductive. If you work so hard, forget the man. You work so hard, some of your man don't tell so much lie. You know, to get the woman. Eh? Una drop off a bed and all of this something you wanna do. Right? And you do all of that to procure the relationship. And then you will just drop your hands. And you are no longer doing the things, you know, that you're supposed to do. And then it's a tit for tat thing. You have to understand that the goal here for you is to focus on how to successfully combine work and personal life, family relationships and leisure time into a satisfying life. One that satisfies you first. You can't love somebody unless they love you. The Bible says love your neighbor as. It never says more than. It says as yourself. To the degree to which I love myself is to the degree to which I love Mr. Dunbar. He will only get as much as I'm giving to me. So it's important. You understand? Of course, I require something of him. I require him to love me. And that is a command, by the way. Right? I require him to love me so that I can maintain what I am giving to him. You understand? But at the same time, I have a responsibility to me, to love me, and to preserve me so that I can be the best for me and the best for him. And the benefits of ensuring that time is that you'll feel more organized. You'll feel more organized. Your job will be more fulfilling and your relationship will improve. And the very relationship that can bring the most joy and fulfillment are also the ones that cause you the most sometimes discouragement. Choo-choo. You have to talk truth and shame the devil. You understand? It is true. Yeah? But a big part of bringing balance to your life starts with understanding and managing your expectations. Too many of us are expecting more than we really should expect. We have some ideals that are up here that them are reachable, them are attainable. You understand? Like I talked about earlier on. So we have to learn to manage what we're expecting and to manage what you can control. Work on what you can control. You can control you? Control you. I tell persons, we have been taking vacations for the last about 25 years. Religiously every year. Religiously. I realize that that's not my husband's strength to plan a vacation. So I'm going to sit down and wait on him to plan it, and then I am miserable and I want a vacation. Perhaps him don't want it. So I plan it every year. Every year I decide where we go, when we go, and for how long we shall go. That is smart. You can stay there and think that me want to plan a date. I'm have a plan it today. You know, sit down there and not go plan a date. Because my strengths are a complement to my husband's weakness and vice versa. So if he's not the planner, if he's not the strategist in the relationship, why am I expecting him to be? Just because I want him to be. You understand? So if I want a vacation every year, I am going to plan my vacation. And then I inform him where we are going. He can give me a card. That's his contribution. Yeah, we all assume that we know the correct way to live and the correct way to do things. You can't manipulate people, and you are not the manufacturer of your husband or your wife. There is a God and you are not him. He manufactured us. He gave us our full set of strengths and weaknesses. Play into your spouse's strength, not their weakness, and do your part. It is teamwork, Dora said, that make the dream work. You understand? So, in many cases, a person's view of our balance of what is right or wrong is incorrect. Right? So you have to do what you need to do to ensure that you get to the place. So I coined some helpful questions that will help you. I heard some before to generate a discussion where balancing is concerned. Do you spend quality time with family? Do you take the time to do that? As busy as I am, I take the time. You see Monday? It names sexy time. I do not see a client. I sleep late. I wake up. I do what I want to do for that entire day. And when it's about time for Mr. Dunbar to, I won't say come home, to return home from work, I get as sexy as heaven. Because I must be the sight for sore eyes and not the cause of it. So you must have, you have to put some time, put some schedule to your times. So I ensure that I be what I want him to see. When he comes home from all the distractions that he will have at work and what he passes on the road coming home. When he comes home and he has a look at me, it's supposed to obliterate from his mind everything else that he has seen for the rest of the day. You understand? I must be the center of his attention. I must be the one causing him to stand on all 3 feet. Nothing else and nobody else. You understand? So you must decide what you want. I know you can't be like me, your teachers. You can't get Monday off. But good God Almighty, you get some time off. You get some time off. If it's even in the afternoon when you come from work, you get some time off. If it's even on weekends. But let me tell you something. You won't just get it, you know, you have to create it. Create it. Put it there and block it. Look here, I tell everybody, you know, I only share my husband with 2 women, you know. Alexia and Siri. They help me to set my schedule. If it is even the schedule for sex. They help me. You understand? I put in what I want to get out. Why not using the technology? You never hear the keynote speaker said use technology. Okay. You can't remember that him needs some sex? Tell Siri to remind you. Or Alexia. Or whoever it is that you use. You understand? But that is it. Yeah? So, do you spend quality time? How do you feel about the quality of the alone time that you have? I take myself away from my husband 2 days every month. He never understood in the initial stage why I needed it, but he understood after. So 2 days every month, I go aside to meet with God, but also to recalibrate myself. When I come back from those 2 days, I am better for him, and I am better for God, and I'm better for everybody else. Yeah? So how much time alone do you spend? I was saying on my Love and Line feature this Wednesday that making space for the you in us in a relationship is so important. Yeah? It's not about secrecy. It's about privacy. It's about understanding that though you are one, you are an individual. You understand? And your spouse will not always do all the things that you like to do. And nothing is wrong if you can do them by yourself. I don't wait on my husband to play a game if I want to. I don't wait on him to take me dinner if I want to go. I go by myself. He's okay. He's not threatened. I really have only eyes for him. I can't stop somebody from being attracted to me. I'm not attracted to them. You understand? And that's what's important, because trust is a bedrock foundation of our relationship. It's a pillar. And so it's important, right? How much time do you need with family and friends? You can socialize outside of your marriage in a non-threatening way. How much time do you need for that? Are you communicating that to your spouse? It's so important. How do you feel about our calendar, you and your spouse, and the pace of your life? Are you getting enough exercise and sleep? How do you feel about the amount of time technology has on your life? Because I see this, it pings ever so often. So I learned to silence mine. I usually never used to take it into my bedroom, as a matter of fact, because I cannot allow. You ever make love yet an ear ping? And for us ladies, we are easily distracted. Our men might not be able to distract themselves when they're at the point of no return, but we can be easily distracted anywhere in between. Right? So I usually, as a rule, never take them in there. Right? But now we can silence them. Right? The goal of this conversation should be to understand your priorities and needs and then discuss how you go about it. You see, what I do, you know, is I live by design and not by default. You can't say, boy, you understand? Nothing ever just happens. You have to get up and make it happen. And if you want your romance to be high up on your list, and if you want to always feel energized and everything about your love life and your intimacy, then I say it already, you have to put it in. Live by design and not default. I know who I was designed to be. You understand? I became a sex therapist. Yes, a part of that was in me. I became a marriage and family therapist. But I'm living by design. The first keynote speaker spoke so much about purpose. It's so important that you know what you are designed to be about and that you are passionate about it. I love what I do, so I never get tired. I can stay here and talk about sex all day. I can talk about marriage and family sustenance all day. And I may get fatigued, but never tired. And there's a difference, right? So you need to know what you're so passionate about. And if your marriage and your family is so important to you, then put the work in so that you can get the work out. It's really so important. It's critical. You understand? What you know about you will help you to build your life. So you have to do it. The Bible says in Hosea, my people are destroyed for what? All right. See it there? You know the Bible. So you need to know what you need to do, because if you don't do it, then you're going to fall short of everything. You have to find out what is your strength. Like I say, don't be a Carla Dunbar. About what you think I'm supposed to be. I said it on TV the other night. A lot of people know my personality. They don't really know me. So because I write about sex, you think that some of the husbands, they are jealous of my husband because they think my husband is getting all the sex that he desires and then some. But if you have a conversation with him, he'll tell you, not so, but when he does get it, it is all that he dreams of. So like many of you women here, I get exhausted, I get tired, and sex is really not at the top of my list. There are so many other important things, like I crave intimacy more than I crave sex. And at my age, and the color of my hair is not an indication of my age, it is a hair color that I carefully chose. Right? Good. So just so that you know. Right? But sex is not at the top of my list. There are other things like family commitment and money. and affection and quality time. All of those things for me are more important than the sex itself. But guess what? I understand the importance of sex to my husband. So be it a lizard lap, a picture frame, a roast duck, whatever it is. What is his desire becomes my great aspiration. My daughter asked me a few weeks ago at the beginning of our gym. We do a once a month Grow Your Marriage Ministry free feature for those persons who just love a free date evening, including refreshments. And she came to me as she was moderating the gym and she said, Mommy, what keeps you and Daddy together? And where are you in the five stages of a relationship? Because just the few days before, I was sharing online that there are five stages to a relationship. And the final stage would be wholehearted love. And I said to her, I think we are at wholehearted love at this stage. We don't argue half as much. We disagree still, but not about anything that is really important and detrimental. And she said, so what do you do? I said, I do what your father wants. Do I look like a yes man? Not at all. But I am in a relationship. And so the relationship has to become my priority. And I'm not in a relationship with everybody. I'm in a relationship with my husband. So what is important to him becomes important to me. And that is where you have the challenge. Some of you are married and still trying to just do you. You signed up for us. You signed up for our. And you signed up for we. But you're still trying to do me and I. And I'm not saying you're to neglect yourself. Do I look like someone who has neglected herself? I told her that I'm just recovering from a stroke. I was headed to Israel and Dubai 2 months ago, and when I landed in America, about 5 hours after, I had a stroke where I was unresponsive for close to 7 hours. But here I am. I take care of myself because I need to for me, right? But my husband is my priority. Because I entered into a relationship with him. I chose to take on somebody else to myself. And so I have to give that the priority that that deserves. And so I ensure that I spend time doing what he likes for me to do. You understand? In the context of when we have that time together. I spend some of my creative time deciding what other sex position I can come up with. Why should I leave that to Adam and Eve alone? Why should I leave it to the whims and fancies of the Kuma Sutra? Why should I leave it to the joys of sex? There's so much more. I came from a creative God, and I have some of his genes. So I spend some of my time thinking about a different position. That's why I created a few and then some, and you can find them in Sexcription. If you choose to purchase a copy, or if you want to stay limited in knowledge, you can choose not to. Right? But I think it's important, right, that we do that. When I wrote my couple's devotional, it's about balancing our lives together. It's about spending some quality time, not every day of the week, because I'm cognizant that we may not be able to have our devotions together. He goes east for work and I stay put. But if we can do it one time per week, it's the quality time that we spend together and not the quantity of our devotional life. And that helps us to be better. Because when you tap into the source, do you know that God can give you creativity beyond your wildest imagination? All of the sex positions that I have come up with that you will not find in the Kuma Sutra and the joys of sex, right? Because they are authentically Jamaican. Have you seen a Hilti in the Kuma Sutra? Or a Plunger? Or a Escovitch Nookie? Or a Cotch and Quint? Or a K-Swiss? Google them. You will not find them in there because they are not there. They are authentically Jamaican because they are authentically Carla and Nalo. Right? Because I take time to create what I want to see happening in my relationship. A lot of the time, the work, man, your jobs, it causes ebb and flow in your relationship. And so you're not even maximizing your time in your relationship where romance is concerned. You don't spend the time. You look about everything else. But the thing that is supposed to be important. This is my bedroom. My bedroom is my boudoir. It's my place. And so I ensure that whatever is in it is meant to be utilized. You understand? So, for instance, I have a chair in there that is often utilized. It often has to be rewrapped because I don't feel like changing it because it's serving its purpose. And every time my husband and I use the chair, my husband will say, Carla, let us find the person we bought it for and pay them for it again. That's how good the chair is. I don't know if you want to put a chair in your bedroom or you want to put a table. But whatever you need to put in there to ensure that you enhance your levels of creativity in the era of your romance, you do it. You understand? If it's date night, you do it. You have to put in what you want to get out. If it is that you're supposed to go on dates, plan the date. And if you're not going anywhere, do it at home. I have often said, give the children them some DPH. No nurse not there. The ones who need a little DPH need to get it. I don't know where Travis is at this point, but I'm about to close. Right? But I'm just saying, yes, create the time. Children are what we make them. You are teachers, you ought to know that. You understand? They not only live what they learn what they live. And so when you create the time, when I have the opportunity to keep my granddaughter so that my son and his wife can go on a date, and she wants to call him, I said to them, no, you can't call them. And she says, why? She's 8 years old. So why is her favorite word? Well, she preached the other day and she said her favorite word in that message is going to be, guess what? So when she said why, I said, because mommy and daddy has to spend some time together alone. I said, do you want the marriage to be sustained? Do you want your family to be together? She said, yes, Graham. I said, well, they have to go out sometime by themselves. Create a date nights. Do it at home. If it's home is where you have to do it. If you don't have the money, it don't take money to have a date night. My husband can recall his very best memory of one of our dates, and it's one that we did at home. When we just relocated, I never had any money. And I put myself all out to ensure that it was memorable, and he remembers it. Not just for the tricks in trade, but for what I put into it. If it's date night, do it. If it's your conversation, have them. You can't be afraid to talk to the person that you decided to spend your life with. Have the conversations will only make the romance sweeter. So you need to do what you need to do. Because if you allow for work to take up and consume all of your life, then you will certainly not have a life. At the end of the day, your bank account may be yay high, but where would be the quality of your life? You'd be telling a lie. I want the balance. I want the best of both balance. So I want good life. I want money in my bank account. I want investments. I want my husband retained because he and I are supposed to live like we, like Abraham and Sarah till them son way. And everything must be in working condition. Yes, but we're not entertaining anything phallic around here. That's why I have Arnie goat weed out there. And I don't bring anything to you that we're not doing ourselves. You understand? So we do what we need to do. We enhance the levels of our intimacy in our relationship to ensure we stoke the fires. It's not the guy who write the play alone there that don't know that if you want the pot for boil, who'd have to push a fire? And gentlemen are pushing too much, who do need to push something else? Because a lot of the time that's all you're pushing. And by the way, the tongue is mightier than the sword. And you need to know that too. You understand? So that you need to get, yet inject what you want into the relationship, into what you want in the relationship. You know, if you were watching my presentation, you'd see that I used the four stages of sex for the headings. The arousal, the plateau, the climax, and the afterglow. A lot of the times you have completed all four stages and the women are left hanging. Yes, with incomplete sentences looking at your dangling participles. So you need to understand where you are at. Take us on a journey towards a destination. Because a lot of the time you arrive at the destination by yourself. And for good men, that is not even desirable. You understand? We need to come together, or with a little practice, you can come in right behind her, which you should. Because she should have multiple orgasmic experiences before you have your own ejaculation. And a lot of the times women feel like we are a hand job or a blow job. We are not. Let us be a part of the journey. Gentlemen, take us to the place. And let us stay there for a while and savor the ecstasies. Because that is what we want to do. And you ladies, you ought to do your own work too. In my book, I take you to meet the guys. Because it's imperative that you know the guys, that you know about them. You should not facilitate something inside of you that you have never seen. And a lot of you have never seen it. You can't recognize it. If it gets amputated from the rest of the male figure of your husband, you wouldn't recognize it. You need to know it. You need to feel it. You need to taste it. It is your sugar cane. You can either eat it, lick it, suck it, or you can let unstick it. The choice is yours. But you have a responsibility. No, you have a responsibility because it's yours. You're not borrowing it. It's not somebody's phone. It is yours. So you must get familiar with it. Feel the throb. Understand how it gets to the place where it gets. You understand? So that you leave them hanging and wanting, salivating for more. We have a responsibility, you know, to balance home and the job. And you can either allow it to get the better of you or you can get the best of it. The choice is really yours. A lot of things lead to sex. And so sex is really the icing on the cake and not the cake itself. So take the time to do the baking. Put in the ingredients. Get the stirring a-going. Put the methods together and combine them so professionally that what you are tasting. Oh my God, see somebody just come down this a while ago. Help them out from there. You understand? So I need you to do it. Some of you gentlemen, you would not be able to find our G-spot without a flashlight. And even with a flashlight, you are still groping around in the dark. And the G-spot is overrated. Find our clitoris. It's situated right on top. Your penis will never come in contact with it unless you directly put it there. There's no sex position. If you can tell me one sex position that allows your penis to come in contact, I'll give you a copy of sex scripture. To come in direct contact with your female clitoris without you taking your hand and steering it in that direction, I'll give you a copy of sex scripture. There is none. That means that your wife's clitoris is meant to be engaged pre-penetration. You don't get it. Stop trying to erase your clitoris like you want it to disappear. That's not what it's meant for. You understand? And do the things that you need to do to ensure that you get to the place, man. You are disconnecting us. Your hands are roaming like digital and stop in three places. Breast, bottom, and vagina. We have other body parts. Get with the program. Engage our minds. This is where sex starts for us up here. How you leave us in the morning is how you'll come home and find us in the night. So if you leave us disgruntled, you never connect with us throughout the day. When you come over, we are disconnected. So you have to engage us. My husband said a woman is like a car. Engage our engine. Ensure that you set it right. I came down with my assistant Travis yesterday in his Bimmer. And one of the things he told me when he first bought it is that he was trying to find a dipstick. Some of us, no dipstick not anymore. You understand? So you need to engage what you need to engage so that your wife gets the best of the experience. Take care of her love languages. Find out what her emotional needs are so that you can meet them and you have a better quality of life. Because when your home life is okay, your work life is so much better. Your productivity at work is so much better. Get a good couple of orgasms without even penetration. And then you're after a good start. Engage your wives. And wives, do not lock shop on your husbands just because you're disgruntled about something. The Bible tells you in 1 Peter 3 and verse 1, it is said when your husband observes your chaste conduct coupled with respect of him, that he functions better. Yeah? Allow him to see and not just hear. We talk a lot. I know we have two tongues, but reserve one, no? Because we talk a lot, and the Bible never tells us to talk a lot. It tells us that we must allow them to see. They are observant. Yes, allow them to see how you respect them. Allow them to see, you know, how you will honor them. And sometimes you'll get a better reaction out of them. You understand? If you are the ones, and we hear a lot of talk about God inside here, and I'm happy for that. But if you are a God wife, then you are going to follow the examples of God and the teachings of God to a T. Because not all the time Mr. Dunbar pleases me. But I seek to please him because I'm honoring God. And that is what is most important for me, honoring God. So be it in my work life, be it in my play life, be it in my sex life, I strive to the highest in ensuring that God is honored by the honor that I give to my husband. If I give my husband 100% because I understand that my marriage is other-centered and not self-centered, then my husband has no recourse but to give me 100%. And ladies, we can't wrap the man around a little finger anytime. So do it. That's why you get feminine wiles. But some of you are looking and acting like men. It's not attractive. Because good men don't want anybody of the same gender. Good men don't want that. So be a female. Act like a female, speak like a female. And I know some of them, like I said, them short circuit or responses, but never lose your feminineness. It is important. It is your unique identity, your intrinsic identity. Don't lose it in the equation of your relationship. As rough as work is out there, when you're coming home, what I have learned to do is to leave the counselor in my office. And I leave the bishop over at the temple. I come home as Mrs. Dunbar. That's what I do. I come to my husband as Mrs. Dunbar. You know, no matter what kind of stress him coming from work with, he is going to see Mrs. Dunbar when he steps into the house. And so I'm saying to you, if you want the best of both worlds in the balancing of both your work and your love life, you have to do what it requires to ensure that you get it there. So teachers, ladies and gentlemen, of this wonderful profession in which we have all come under to learn some of the things that we have learned in this life, it is up to you whether or not your husband speak in other tongues and use up him tongue, and if he can't, send him to me. I probably can help him with something that will help him out. Because sometimes their tongues are heavy and it needs a little lightning so that they can manipulate it. Right? If that is not happening, use what God has given you and show them how you honor them. And I'm sure that you'll get it right. And gentlemen, I know sometimes my husband said, Carly, I'm miserable like old goat. I will not deny it. Because if things are not going the way that I expect them to go, if I don't understand how other things are working out outside of the bedroom, because I know that everything that happens in the bedroom has its bearing on what is happening outside of the bedroom. And I'm not saying that you have to limit everything to the bedroom. Because if it is your house and the furnitures are yours, then do what you must to ensure that you have joy and ecstasies. But I am saying, even if it doesn't, he must understand and know what my needs are, the full composite of them. He will understand that I am multidimensional and I'm ever changing like the waves of the ocean. But if he comes alongside me, we can ride the waves together. He can get a smooth sailing or a turbulent ride, and the choice will be his. What you want, you must be able to put in. You cannot make withdrawals when you have not made any investment or deposits. If you want romance, you have to put the rowing into the romance to get what you need to get out of it. If it is great sex that you need, you have to create the experience so that the ride speaks for itself. If you want qualitative work life, then you have to put in the work, burning the midnight oil to ensure you get it. Remember, it's not about perfecting. It's not about being perfect. It's about perfecting. It's not about balance. It's about balance in. It's a continuous process. But eventually, like a good comb, you'll get to it. It's a ride from the arousal to the plateau. Something will be jumping. Something will be throbbing. Something will be quinting. But if you spend enough time to take the ride, you will get to the destination together. And God will be pleased when you are both giving him the praise. May God bless you as you continue to balance, not acrobatically, but romantically, so that your lives will be a benefit to you all at the end of the day. God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. 5626 HM, you are blocking. Macaroot is on sale. Yes, you must be practical. Ladies, you have a responsibility under God. Gentlemen, the tongue is mightier than the sword. Macaroot and a lot of things are on sale. I hear that the macaroot is good. I don't know about it. One thing I know about the macaroot is that it is bitter. All right. Don't ask me how I know it is bitter. I've never used it. And so at this time, I'm inviting Mrs. Jacqueline Hendricks White. She's coming to say thanks to Dr. Dunbar. But in the meantime, we have lots of things here that we cannot take back home. And so we want to give them away. In order to give them away, we are going to be doing something. So, if you can sing well, we have a karaoke machine right here waiting. I know teachers can sing. All you need to do is to just let us know. We need about 10 persons. All you need to do is to just let us know. And we get the song, and you run your show, and we take it from there. So, remember, you choose if you want an orgasmic experience or you want to go back home. So,
thank you so much, Mr. McNamee. So, colleagues, we invite you to register for the karaoke at the table closest to the door. May I invite Bishop Dr. Carla Dunbar? This is a woman, a true woman of God. You are never tired to listen to her. Today, Bishop, you spoke to us about balancing work and personal relationship, win, lose, or draw. And as I looked at the facial expressions of my colleagues, I realized they're in a winning mode because they have just realized how important sex is to the daily running of their work. They have also understood that sex is just a penetration. It comes with how you look, how you smell, and sex must appeal to the senses. And so we are going home. We are clearing the clutter. Because if you have venom, you can't have a good sex life. And we believe in keeping our man on 3 feet, so it's 1 yard, all the time. And so, Dr. Bishop, may the Holy Spirit continue to bloom, to blow on you, that as you go, you grow and glow and help us all to have better lives, better home lives, and enjoy what God created us to do. Have fun. Bless you.
Excellent, excellent, excellent. Again, thank you, Dr. Dunbar. Very inspirational presentation. Colleagues, while you're eating your food, we're going to be taking about 15 minutes for you to find the restroom and get yourself well relaxed for the next session. So we're on for just 15 minutes. Just get to the back, that PAC table, right where Melissa is at the back, to get your name down and your song choice for the karaoke. We have some great prizes and we don't want to take them back
home.
Yes,
indeed.
Yesterday was Teacher's Day and we want you to take home something because Believe it or not, some teachers never get nothing. And you may talk, just some. All right.
And so we continue, sir, to ignite the passion. Yes, as we advance education. Colleagues, we are indeed going to have a wonderful...
No, it's not going to be only karaoke, but make sure... the only way you can take home something is if you're in here.
Participate.
We just need 10 people for the karaoke. But with the amount of something what we have is more than what Dr. Dunbar talked about. So make sure, so you're in here, that you get something. If you don't get, if it's not for you, you can carry it for him.
And may I just remind our colleagues, Brother McNamee, that karaoke is fun. It is not necessarily for the professional. It's for those of us who have a short of breath when you sing like me.
Most definitely.
Yes, so come on, show your strut.
Yes.
We are here to have fun. It is Ellen Sills Professional Development Day 2023.
Melissa is at the back taking the registration. You just go.
So look to the door. Yes. You'll see a hand.
Yes.
Just come and be registered. You will be glad you did. Remember, whatever you take out is what you put in.
Yes.
Invest well.
And of course, we have a lot to give away, and I am a natural giver, so you shall receive.
Mr. DJ,